I'm telling you, that don't put us on TV too much. Hold up.
Texas, where the folks of the Southwest are ready to ride in the new year. And today, football fans from the South and the West have converged for this duel in the desert. CBS Sports is proud to present the Brute Sun Bowl, the South Florida Bulls against the Oregon Ducks. And a big welcome to the Sun Bowl, the 40th edition here on CBS. Many believe Oregon was headed to the BCS title game back in mid-November until injury took out their quarterback. And South Florida's program is only 11 years old, but now a contender and ranked in the top 25. Craig Bullerjack joined along with Steve Berline, and when Dennis Dixon went down for Oregon, it shook that program to the core.
Well, Craig, you're exactly right. Anytime a team loses a starting quarterback, it's a big deal. In the case of the Oregon Ducks, losing Dennis Dixon was devastating. It's forced Mike Bellotti, the coach for Oregon, to turn to redshirt freshman quarterback Justin Roper, who will make his first start today. And I think, Craig, it goes without saying, this team is going to be dependent on Jonathan Stewart in a big way today. He's one of the top two or three running backs in the country. He's right up there with Darren McFadden at Arkansas, and he's a tremendous player. They're going to count on him heavily, coming off a nagging turf toe injury. He told us it's an issue. He can't give us a percentage, but he says he's going to be ready to play today.
He said, let's lace it up and play this football game. Now, South Florida is a major player in the Big East, and they have major players, Steve, on both sides of the football.
They really do. It's a team that maybe you haven't heard too much about. They haven't gotten a lot of national coverage, but their quarterback, Matt Grothy, and George Silvey, their starting defensive end, these are two big-time playmakers. Matt Grothy, he is a guy that can kill you with his legs, both in the running game and in the passing game. He's a great running quarterback, makes tremendous plays when things break down. On the other side of the ball, George Silvey, he is as big a playmaker as there is in college football. Defensive end, he can bring it off the edge. The Oregon Ducks, I guarantee you, will know where that guy is at all times on the football field.
This is the third straight bowl appearance for South Florida. And just moments ago, emotions very high in the Bulls locker room. Coming up, the 74 Sun Bowl, South Florida and Oregon, next right here on CBS. CBS Sports presentation of the Brute Sun Bowl is sponsored by Brute Revolution, as different as you are. Progressive, making insurance better. And by Taco Bell, think outside the bun. Paso, and a big welcome to the Oregon Ducks from the Pac-10. And the Bulls of South Florida seeking their first 10-win season in their 11-year program history. And time to welcome the third member of our CBS team. Let's go downstairs and Sam Ryan. Sam?
And Craig, for South Florida, all season long, their motto has been finish strong, from the seniors who helped build this program to the underclassmen as well. Now, that was evident after the team lost their three losses in a row, what they call gut-wrenching losses to Rutgers, UConn, Cincinnati, losing those three games by a combined 15 points, but were able to turn it around and win their final three games of the season. That the senior Walt Walker told me that they're all wearing this bracelet, which says finish strong on it. He said the fact that they were able to right the ship, that they didn't crumble, speaks volumes of their camaraderie and leadership. They're trying to become the first 10-win team in school history, Craig.
Thank you, Sam. Stay tuned for the kickoff of the 74th Sun Bowl next here on CBS. Well, the weather in El Paso, beautiful day, 54 degrees, and the forecast is sunny skies. Well, experience college football on CBS today, brought to you in high definition by Sony. South Florida won the toss. They'll take it to start the third quarter, so Oregon will be on offense to start the 74th Sun Bowl here in El Paso. Oregon's Steve Beuerlein is 8-4, ended their 12-game schedule, losing their last three. South Florida is 9-3 and finished off their regular season schedule with three straight wins. The head coach of the Bulls, Jim Leavitt, in his 11th season, has built this program from the bottom up. And the Mike Bellotti, the head coach of Oregon, 13th season as the Ducks head coach, 105 victories along the way.
And Craig, you cannot overemphasize the importance of this football game to both of these organizations. You know, Oregon starting out the season, getting to the point where they were 8-1, number two in the country. This thing is falling apart, losing three in a row. They have to end this season on a positive note. And for South Florida, as you stated, the opportunity to win 10 games for the first time in their history, it's a big deal to end this season on the right note.
So the Pac-10 against the Big East in the 74th Sun Bowl and the 40th edition here on CBS. And the kick is away. Tichy is going to knock this one out of the end zone. So Oregon will start at their own 20-yard line. Let's take a look at the starting lineups presented today by Applebee's. The quarterback is redshirt freshman Justin Roper, started the season on the scout squad, and today makes his first career start in the Sun Bowl. Roper is in good hands up front. The center is Max Unger, earned first team all Pac-10 honors this season. And Roper also has, don't forget, Jonathan Stewart in that backfield, averaging nearly 6 yards a carry. And Justin Roper, 6'6", 205-pounder, the most athletic, and has the strongest arm of the quarterback since Dennis Dixon went down with injury. And on first down, the rollout, and in the flat, the ball is caught as Garen Strong, the senior from San Jose. And defensively for South Florida, make sure you keep your eye on number 95. The right end, George Selby, is a consensus first-team All-American. Linebackers, very good. Ben Moffitt, the best in the Big East. And the secondary is led by the corner, Trey Williams, with 16 career interceptions. Well, on the first play, Roper connects for a 17-yard gain. Out of the pocket he goes, and the ball again is thrown near side, this time caught by Jeff Mayle. And a flag is down, and so Oregon comes out throwing with the redshirt freshman at quarterback.
That was a very cool play right there, Craig. That was they're going to call for a forward lateral, I believe.
A referee today, Bill Algy, and the officials from the Mid-American Conference.
LA illegal forward pass. Number 11, offense. Penalized from 5 yards from the spot of the pass. Loss of down. Second down.
And you're going to see right here, it's a great play. I love the creativity. They had this thing. I'm sure Mike Bellotti is tremendously disappointed. That's a play they put in for that particular situation. And just the running back got a little bit too far ahead of Justin Roper, and that ball did definitely go forward. It was supposed to be a backwards pass. Too bad that play didn't work for the Ducks.
Second down and 13 from the shotgun. Little pitch out as Mayo ran across the middle. Breaks a tackle to the 50-yard line. Oh, the ball comes loose! And South Florida recovers at the 45-yard line.
Well, the South Florida Bulldogs are the number one team in the country as far as turnovers. They've created 41 turnovers coming into this game. And right there you see, Mayo's got the ball. But right there, that last hit, the late hit by Carlton Williams, number 32, is what popped that ball out of there. South Florida has been capitalizing all year on big plays by their defense. Get the ball back in good field position.
42nd takeaway this season. And so after a couple of impressive plays by Oregon, they cough it up, and the Bulls take over at the 46, and a bad snap to Grothy, and he has to take a seat at the 33-yard line. And the lineups for South Florida, Grothy the quarterback. You mentioned about his arm, but terrific legs, holds the school rushing record for quarterbacks. And up front, Grothy's protected by a huge line. Their average weight, 315 pounds. And many targets for Grothy to throw to. One of his favorites, Carlton Mitchell. 37 receptions on the season, and he's a burner. Owns 4.3 speed in the 40.
And a true freshman. Set all the freshman receiving records this year. 37 catches over 500 yards. He is the burner and the man to keep an eye on out there.
Well, we've seen a fumble. We've seen a bad snap in the first couple of minutes of the Sun Bowl. Grothy sets those feet up top. He goes! Oh, terrific defense in the backfield by Jairus Byrd. Knocked that ball away from Mitchell.
And we told you about Mitchell. He's the big play guy up the field. That ball a little bit underthrown. You can see he was definitely open. Jairus Byrd was beaten on the play, but Close did a tremendous job of making a break on the ball. Matt Grothy read that the free safety left the middle of the field, wanted to take advantage of it, just underthrew that ball a little bit. And if nothing else, though, they've established the fact that Carlton Mitchell can get open up the field. The Oregon Ducks better be careful.
Four wide receivers set, three, top of your screen on third down and 23. Grothy, the sophomore from Lakeland, Florida, from the shotgun, good protection. Now flush out of the pocket, wants to run at the 35 and hook slides around the 39-yard line. And defensively for the Oregon Ducks, Ducks own 35 sacks on the season. They will pursue. Nick Reed owns 12 of those takedowns. Linebackers, Jerome Boyd leads the way with 71 tackles on the season. And the secondary, Steve, is solid. The Rover, Patrick Chung, makes his 38th consecutive start.
And a good solid first drive for the defense of the Oregon Ducks.
Alvarado, the kick, gets it away as Byrd takes it at the 13-yard line, has room up the middle, breaks a tackle, still on his feet at the 35, and taken down from behind at the 40. Terrific return, 47-yard punt. And Byrd runs it back 27.
Great return by Byrd, breaking tackles. It's one of the big things coaches worry about is tackling after the long layoff coming into a bowl game. Right there, a great return by Jairus Byrd.
Well, Steve, major coaching changes around the college football scene. Bo Pelini from LSU to Nebraska. Neuheisel just recently leaves the National Football League. Baltimore to UCLA. Petrino's out at Atlanta, goes to Arkansas. Nutt out at Arkansas to Ole Miss. And Rodriguez shaking up the world a little bit from West Virginia to Michigan. And we've just learned from the National Football League that Brian Billick fired after the Ravens go 5-11. So he's on out looking for a job.
He is looking for a job, and he'll be snatched. He'll get an opportunity somewhere, I think. And You know, the Ravens lost 9 games in a row coming into the Pittsburgh win yesterday. Hard for any coach to weather that kind of storm. I don't care what the situation's been. They had a lot of injuries in Baltimore. Brian Billick will end up on his feet, though. I know that much.
Second offensive series for the Oregon Ducks, and they will spread the field. 5 wide receivers, and did they get the playoff? No. It was down to 1. It ran dry, and that's going to cost Justin Roper 5.
Delay game. Offense penalized 5 yards. Remains first down.
The line.
Well, for the University of Oregon, the key is 3rd down. Before Dennis Dixon got hurt, they were up at 46%. Since that time, they're down around 24%. Not very good with a young quarterback. They got to convert. And for the USF defense, you got to force the issue. Bring pressure on this young quarterback. Create turnovers, as we've already seen. That's how you're going to win this game.
Roper slingshots it across the middle. One at Jason Williams. It falls incomplete. McKenzie, the strong side linebacker on the defense. That brings up 2nd down and 15. Justin Roper, can you go inside his head? This is a young man that a few weeks ago was scout squad quarterback, now starting in the Sun Bowl.
And fortunately for Justin Roper, he's had the full month to get ready for this game. So he's more comfortable than he was a month ago, I guarantee you that.
Handoff runs it to the far side, and it's to their consensus All-American, Jonathan Stewart. They're playing a little hide-and-seek out there early.
Well, and you know what? We knew there was going to be some of this stuff. When you give coaches at this level the ability to have a month to get ready for a ball game, they're going to come up with some creative stuff. And Jonathan Stewart right there, the beneficiary, was almost like they had lined him up in a wing position, an underneath handoff around the edge, a nice sweep, good solid pickup for Oregon, and nice creativity in their offensive game plan so far.
A gain of 15, 1st and 10. Roper slides it out to the near side. Oh, slipping down is Jeff Mail. And the true freshman from Paradise, California, could not make the cut. And what looked to be a big play is a loss of 1.
Well, what we're going to see here, obviously Justin Roper cannot run like Dennis Dixon. There aren't many guys in the NCAA that can run like Dennis Dixon, but they're still going to run some variations of the read option, and they're doing some trickery off of that. That play right there, another example. Fake the run and have him pass the ball outside.
Oh, they misdirection as Stewart. You saw the wave of Ducks go right, and they come back left, and a good read by the Bulls defense. Yeah, there's Dennis Dixon, the Pac-10 Player of the Year. And, Steve, it's simple. Devastating injury. 8-1 before, number 2 ranking in the country. Since then, 0-3.
Well, look at that right there, too. 18.3 points a game, down from 46 points a game. That shows the effect. And Justin Roper, they believe he's going to be a very good quarterback. He's got a lot of learning to do.
Takes it up top. Had man coverage with Williams. Incomplete. And Trey Williams, that tough cover corner, back making his second big play here early in the quarter. That brings up 4th down and 9.
And these two cornerbacks for the University of South Florida, Trey Williams and Michael Jenkins, these guys are as good as it gets. Both of them rated very highly by the NFL. In fact, Mel Kiper lists Michael Jenkins, the other corner, as the top-rated cornerback prospect in the country. Trey Williams, as you said, 6 interceptions this year, Craig, and 3 of them have gone for touchdowns. So Justin Roper better be careful out there today.
Josh Sirey punts it away. Marcus Edwards lets that ball take a bounce, and it's taken an Oregon bounce inside the 10, rolling to the 6-yard line. 43-yard kick. We're scoreless in El Paso.
To the 25, fumbled. Maryland's got it.
Scored 3. Thurman Thomas.
McWilliams tipped, intercepted.
Holmes leaps. What a play. Touchdown, Texas.
Some terrific moments on CBS as we celebrate 40 years of the Sun Bowl. And today, South Florida, 25th ranked against Oregon. At 1 point this season, ranked number 2. And now the Bulls will start deep inside their own territory after that punt down to the 6-yard line. Mike Ford, Benjamin Williams are split between Matt Grothy. Ford takes the handoff, trod to left side, maybe a yard. And Oregon, seventh best ranked defense in the Pac-10, Steve, this season, about 386 yards a ball game. They're physical, they move very well.
And they're better than the seventh ranked defense in the Pac-10. Their numbers statistically show that, but they are a very, very aggressive, sound defense, very opportunistic. They create a lot of plays and try and obviously make plays in the backfield, try and create third and long situations, and then they really let their guys up front go and try and put pressure on the quarterback.
Second down and nine, two wideouts to the near side, and Grothy now takes a look at that Oregon defense and calls timeout. Did not like what he saw, and a timeout in El Paso. Beautiful day in El Paso, Texas, 54 degrees at game time. And so far, 36 yards on the ground for Oregon, 16 through the air. And after that timeout, South Florida goes back on offense. Steve looking at second down and nine.
Really important for the Bulls here to try and find a way to get out of their end zone and reestablish field position. They've looked a little out of sync so far.
Hand off, nothing. Mike Ford dropped. A.J. Tuatelli, the outside linebacker, came in to make the tackle.
Yeah, A.J. Tuatelli missed half the season with the broken foot, but he's excited. But look at the penetration right there from Jeremy Gibbs, number 99, shooting through the gap. That's what's been the issue so far. Oregon has been able to create pressure into the backfield. They've had several negative yardage plays, and that really is a situation that Jim Leavitt wants his offense to avoid, because you get a running team without a pure pocket passer in a situation where they're third and long, you're very limited in what you can do.
Well, the Bulls are going backwards. Third down and 10. Grothy in the pocket, 2 yards deep in the end zone. That ball is tipped, and it drops incomplete inside the 20-yard line. Fourth down coming for South Florida.
So far, the Oregon defense is really, really causing a lot of problems for South Florida. You're going to see this ball is tipped, and I don't know whether it would have gotten through there or to the receiver or not, because you see a lot of green jerseys right there around. And Ryan DiPaolo, number 9, the senior free safety, he's the one that was able to hit the receiver coming across the middle field, but he was allowed to make that contact because the ball was tipped.
Oregon will have fined field position as Alvarado set to punt, and Bird is inside the 50-yard line. Gets that ball away. It's a beauty. And how about the hang time? Fair catch at the 45. Well, log on to cbssports.com/whomadeyou to find out who made a difference in your favorite athletes' lives. Hear inspirational stories about the people who influenced and shaped today's hottest athletes. That was a 49-yard punt. Alvarado coming through.
Absolutely tremendous punt. And that was Mike Bellotti, the coach for Oregon, told us special teams was going to be a key in this ball game. He came with the all-out block right there. A lot of pressure on Alvarado from his own end zone, and he delivered a beauty, 49 yards with great hang time.
Third offensive series for the redshirt freshman, Justin Roper. Hand off, sliding through. There's a flag down. Stewart. Oh, he is so tough physically. Goes 5'11", 230, and on his own second and third effort inside South Florida territory at the 48-yard line, but a flag down.
Well, offsides on South Florida. But Jonathan Stewart looking very comfortable, not practicing much.
Offside. Defense. Number 90, penalized 5 yards from the previous spot. Repeat first down.
Oh, Steve, the Ducks won 8 of their first 9. They grabbed that number 2 ranking, but look at this. They have been wounded and wounded and wounded.
Well, obviously, Dennis Dixon is the key injury in there, but so many of these guys, and what's been amazing, you talked to Mike Bellotti, you're going to lose players during the course of the season, but not that many starters with major injuries where they're gone for the whole season.
On first and 5, Stewart tries to cut back, and back around the 49. Well, that last play was stopped. And there's Dixon.
I'll tell you what, I'm extremely impressed with Dennis Dixon. Look how into it he is right there from the sideline. He's trying to make his presence felt any way he can. Tremendous leader. This team really needs him to support Justin Roper. Oh, look at that one.
There's that quick toss. Mayo. and try to take the pressure. Bottom line, Mike Bellotti is trying to take the pressure off this young quarterback, Justin Roper.
He's doing a good job. Look, they faked the handoff underneath the Stewart, almost slammed it into Stewart's helmet. Mayo comes across and makes the play, picks up a nice gain. Dennis Dixon right there saying, good job, good execution. Those plays, they're all about timing, and they're very hard to execute. So far, so good for the Ducks offense.
First and 10, back the other way, near side. Stewart down on a foot, put a hand down to the 40-yard line. In fact, they'll mark him out at the 39 as Ben Moffitt made the hit. Stewart, limited practice time, Steve, as you mentioned, with the turf toe. He showed off that toe, by the way, yesterday to us. It's not pretty.
No, it is not pretty.
And he's had to stretch the shoe out to give that toe some room to breathe a little bit.
Because that toe is so swollen. And people don't, if you don't know what turf toe is, you don't understand, especially for a running back, how significant an injury that is. And it has limited his practice. That's a concern Mike Bellotti had. But Jonathan Stewart looks very comfortable out there right now.
Roper on play action, throws it out to the flat, and it's caught as Williams and the Ducks are moving the football on South Florida. Carlton Williams, a strong safety, made the tackle.
Well, one of the concerns that Mike Bellotti and his staff had, Chip Kelly, the offensive coordinator, coming into this game, was how to alleviate the pressure. South Florida does a great job of creating pressure defensively. One of the things they said was play action. They've done a nice job of mixing in some play action, giving Justin Roper some easy throws.
Back to the ground, a little slip on that cut. Andre Crenshaw, who's in for Stewart, the sophomore from Lancaster, California. Tackled down to the 31-yard line. So about a yard loss on the play. Now you have to be impressed. We talked to Roper in length yesterday, Steve, and here's a guy you would think would be very excited, but boy, he was calm. He said, that's just who I am. I understand what I'm going through, but I don't show a lot of emotion. Shotgun again, they hand off. Crenshaw cuts it to the 25-yard line, and now a late flag is dropped out of the pile. Nate Allen and Tyrone McKenzie teamed up to make the tackle. Personal foul, Oregon.
Against Oregon, yeah. Interesting to see who it was they nailed on that one, but after a good positive play, you don't want a bad thing like this.
Dead ball, personal foul, late hit on the offense, number 60, penalized 15 yards from the end of the run. It'll be third down.
That's the team captain on the offensive side, the center, Max Unger.
Yeah, there he is, just coming in late on the play there. You know what? That's one of those. Was he late? Yes, he definitely was late. Was there an intent to do anything wrong or to hurt anybody? No, he just fallen on the pile. He tried to pull off a little bit, but yes, it was late. Technically, that is a penalty.
Third down, 19. Roper pumps out of the pocket, throws a slingshot downfield at the 10-yard line. How did he make the catch?
Well, that is Derek Jones. Made that catch. Great job by Justin Roper keeping his composure. Look at him step up and avoid the pressure. Under control, makes a nice throw down the middle. If you barely got it in there. And Derek Jones makes the catch for a tremendous pickup. That makes up for the Max Unger penalty.
Only his 19th catch of the season as Mail is pushed out of bounds. Boy, impressive offensive series here put together by Chip Kelly, the offensive coordinator in his first season with the Ducks. Again, you have to be impressed. They've let Roper breathe a little bit out there.
Well, so far, the only thing that's really held up Oregon offensively has been themselves. I think they tried to get a little too cute too early in this game with a few things, and that has come back to haunt them a little bit. But I love the aggressiveness and not holding back for Justin Roper. Let's see what this kid can do out there.
Second down goal. Just outside the 7-yard line. Roper with a play fake, slings it across the middle. Oh, incomplete. And he had the tight end, Ed Dixon, right on. A terrific effort by the free safety, Nate Allen. Put up a hand, knocked it away.
Craig, this ball should have been intercepted. What? This ball goes right through Nate Allen's hands. I mean, look at this. He's in perfect position. There's no reason why he would miss this ball. And South Florida team that is, as we said, the number one team in the country producing turnovers. Nate Allen is going to be kicking himself about that one. You get a turnover deep in your own territory like that, you got to cash in.
And Allen is sure-handed. Four interceptions on the season. He just let number five slip through his hands. Third down and goal from the shotgun. Roper rolls, throws, caught! Touchdown! Garen Strong!
Well, Craig, you mentioned that Justin Roper is 6 foot six. That is what allowed him to make that throw. I think a guy my size, 6 foot two, I would not have thrown that ball. I wouldn't have had the angle to get it up and over, but he took advantage of it, put it right on the money. Tremendous throw.
Now the odd formation for the point after the touchdown from Roper to Strong. Roper on the pitch. Did he make it?
Oh, they're giving it to him.
Down, but broke the plane. That's the kicker, Matt Evenson. So trickery from Mike Bellotti.
I'm a little bit confused as to why they would go for the two-point conversion in this situation. Again, very creative, very well designed. Look at the ball gets over the plane. It's hard to tell from that angle, but Evenson sure as heck thinks he got it over that goal line.
So the young player, Roper, with the touchdown, and then Oregon stunning South Florida. They go for two, and it's an 8-0 lead in El Paso, the 74th Sun Bowl on CBS. MetLife is navigating the skies of El Paso to provide aerial coverage of the game below. Look to the skies with MetLife blimps and plane as they team up with CBS in 2008. Time now for the playbook presented by the Hartford.
Well, Craig, watch the effect of misdirection on the USF defense. Watch with the play action fake. Watch the way the whole defense for University of South Florida flows over there. And then look right here. Nate Allen is actually in great position to make this play when Justin Roper comes out. He just doesn't quite know where the receivers are. He's right there. Justin Roper puts the ball in the only place he can. The misdirection creates good flow away from the play. Justin Roper takes advantage of Nate Allen, not really knowing exactly where he was on the field.
Roper's third touchdown toss of the season and the third touchdown reception for Strong. So now Evenson is set to kick away. How about this? He just scored the two, and he goes back, tees it up, and kicks.
That was a tremendous, an unbelievable effort by the kicker. You don't see many kickers, at least I don't know many kickers, that would be able to stretch it out and give it up like that for the two-point conversion.
Taurus Johnson back to receive, along with Jerome Murphy. Oregon with the 8-0 lead, and the kick is away. Takes a big bounce at the 25-yard line. Johnson at the 15, 25. Breaks the tackle, 35.
Johnson returns from a full
time. And they'll mark him out at the 36-yard line. Sunday on CBS, the amazing race. Teams square off in the streets of Osaka, Japan. Only four teams left in the running for the million-dollar prize. Who will survive the hardest challenges yet? All new, amazing race Sunday after 60 minutes here on CBS. Well, a flag was dropped on that kick return. What a busy first quarter for Bill Algey.
Three of the receiving team penalized 15 yards from the end of the return. It'll be first down, South Florida.
Well, they got Jerome Murphy on the penalty. Jim Leavitt just trying to stop the bleeding right now, trying to figure out a way to get some good things happening for his team.
So first and 10, Bulls will start at the 21-yard line. Five penalties thrown, 43 total yards here in the opening quarter. Still 6:22 to play. Oregon with the 8-0 lead. Benjamin Williams in the backfield. And so far, this ground game of South Florida unable to penetrate Oregon. Unable to push through that line.
Oregon in complete control right now of this tempo from South Florida's offensive perspective. They can't get any kind of rhythm or sync going at all.
David Fatete runs off the field after losing a shoe, made that tackle, and a loss of two, second down and 12. Matt Grothy, shotgun formation. Two-step drop, looks near side, flushed out of the pocket. He can run, still looking, throws it in traffic. And the catch made at the 33-yard line. Give it to Marcus Edwards, who really helped out his quarterback on the comeback.
This is where Grothy's most dangerous. On the move when things break down, a tremendous effort by Marcus Edwards to get down and catch that ball. Coach Jim Leavitt was pushing for a little bit of a PI penalty, too. He wanted a flag, get the extra yardage. But I think you just give Matt Grothy credit and take advantage of the play and move the ball, go to the next one.
Edwards with his 20th reception of the season. First down, 10, Bulls. There's a hit on Benjamin Williams and picks up three. And, Steve, let's go back above the line.
Well, Craig, I really think the key for the University of South Florida offense is to win in the red zone. I think they're going to be able to move the ball up and down the field, but you got to get in the red zone and cash in. Oregon is one of the very best in the red zone. Now, for Oregon on defense, you got to take away Matt Grothy's wheels. His bottom line, he's going to kill you if you let him move the ball with his feet in the running game or in the passing game. You've got to contain him. We saw a good example a couple plays ago. When things break down, he's going to find a way to make a play.
Grothy goes under center on second down and 10, and now a flag.
False start. Number 65, offense, penalized 5 yards, remains second down.
That's the left guard, Ryan Schmidt. A little jump. Well, not your lucky number, that's for sure. Number two teams to lose this season, and there's plenty, Steve Berline, as this college football season's been topsy-turvy. USC, Cal, South Florida, Boston College, Oregon, of course, losing to Arizona by 10. Kansas was there, lost to Missouri.
Well, we're the only bowl game with two teams that were ranked that highly during the course of the season, aside from the BCS championship game.
Tough throw on the toss outside. Grothy to Edwards, and Jerome Boyd was there with the tackle. Edwards with a couple of catches on this offensive series.
And, Craig, you know, we talked about how important it is for Oregon to try and keep Matt Grothy in the pocket so he can't make those plays. But when you talk to Jim Leavitt, and when you talk to offensive coordinator Greg Gregory, they say this guy really is a pretty good pocket passer. They feel that he can beat you from the pocket as well. I have to be convinced. I have to see that still.
Well, Grothy thrown for nearly 2,500 yards this season. Third down and 6. And 4 wide receivers. 3 lined up to the near side. Shotgun, Grothy steps up. Lobs that ball deep. Man coverage. And it falls incomplete. Taurus Johnson was out there, but I think that he got lost. He looked outside, and that ball was thrown on his inside shoulder.
Well, Matt Grothy did a great job of getting to the right play, or his coaching staff did. They line up, and they see the lineup of the defense, and they try and take advantage of the look they're presented with. Another flag on the play here.
And another call for Bill Algie.
Personal foul. Unnecessary roughness. Number 39. Of the defense, penalized 15 yards, automatic first down.
Well, that's Will Tukafu, the defensive end number 39. See, that's 3 personal foul penalties called here in the quarter.
That's just guys that are coming out a little bit too much adrenaline going. They're a little bit too excited out there. They've got to regroup, regain their composure, because plays like that keep drives alive. That was a good job by the Oregon defense of not letting South Florida capitalize on a big play opportunity. Then they give them 15 yards, which is the equivalent of a big play.
Bulls are inside duck territory. Grothy wants to air that ball out middle of the field. That ball's off the hands and nearly intercepted, incomplete. And there's another flag down as Carlton Mitchell, with blazing speed, is still down.
Another one going against the Oregon.
Offside. defense, number 49, lined up in the neutral zone. Penalized 5 yards from the previous spot. Repeat first down.
That one marked off against Nick Reed. And Tuesday, January 8th on CBS, Queen Latifah hosts the People's Choice Award. Pick your favorites in movies, music, and television. It's your vote, your choice, the People's Choice Award. That's Tuesday, January 8th, right here on CBS. Hey. High above the Sun Bowl and beautiful day in El Paso.
That was another opportunity right there, though, that Craig or Carlton Mitchell had a chance to make a play up the field, underthrown by Matt Grothy. And there we see Matt Grothy on the carry, pick up of about 3 yards. But we've seen a concerted effort by the South Florida Bulls to try and find Carlton Mitchell up the field to make these plays. He's been open 2 times. And Matt Grothy has thrown that ball behind him and not given him a chance to make that play up the field. You get those opportunities only rarely in a football game of this level. You've got to cash in when you get those chances.
Couple of rushes, 7 yards for Grothy. As the Bulls look at second down and 4, 3:30 to play, opening quarter. Oregon struck first. A touchdown and a 2-point conversion. This time the Bulls go to the left side behind Dial and Schmidt, and Mike Ford pushes the pile to the 37-yard line.
Well, look at the. This is the first real attitude play that we've seen out of South Florida. The offensive line caving down the whole left side, and then Mike Ford, he's strong like Bull. The South Florida Bulls, he takes it up in there and says, bring me down. I'm going to pick up this first down, and you're going where I want you to go. Vertical, north and south. Good, solid pickup for South Florida.
First down and 10 with 3:05 to play. Grothy, shotgun. Good protection. Ball again tipped and dropped. Even though that ball was tipped, Dontavia Bogan nearly brought that ball down. The freshman from Thomasville, Georgia.
Well, that ball was very fortunate not to be picked off on 2 occasions. He tried to thread it between A.J. Tuatelli, number 34, and Kwame Ajiman, number 30. He put it up over the top of them. The ball was tipped, and then they had a chance to make a play up the field. Matt Grothy dodged the bullet right there.
Hey, Matt, he's good disguise, good disguise.
Grothy at 6 feet, 213 pounds, only a sophomore. Ninth play of this drive. Long count, shotgun again. Grothy stands up, slings it across the middle. It's caught. And on second effort, after the initial hit, another first down. So South Florida using multiple wide receivers, and that's one thing Grothy likes to share that ball.
And that was a good, solid pickup. They had the right look, the right play at the right time called, and Matt Grothy made a good, solid read and put that ball on the money, no doubt about it. Now they're moving inside the red zone, talking about how important it is now. They've got the opportunity. Oregon, the number one red zone defense in the Pac-10.
First and 10. Oh, hear those pads pop. Mike Ford took it right on the helmet. Maybe 2 for Mike Ford. True freshman. Sarasota High School was in the high school ranks a year ago, Steve. And he had ran for 368 yards in one high school football game. Now, high school, yes, much different than Division I football, but 368, pretty impressive.
You look at the film on this guy, you can see how he can do it. He gets those shoulders squared up. He is a big back. He's a physical runner. It's almost like he's looking for someone to come over and challenge him.
Goes 225, tries to spin on a tackle, and another flag is down as Ford is stood up and driven back by Nick Reed. Holding against South Florida.
Holding. Number 61. Offense. Penalized 10 yards from the previous spot. Repeat second down.
And you saw Zach Herman shake his head, the redshirt freshman. A whistle for the holding penalty.
Well, one of the most difficult things about taking the month off before a bowl game is that it takes you, you're not doing anything live. You're not really getting that live game action after having that 11 or 12 game season. All of a sudden, your timing's off a little bit. Your footwork's off a little bit. We've seen some sloppy play on both sides of the ball to this point.
Oregon shows blitz. They come strong, and down goes Grothy, and yet another flag is down. The Ducks came off the water, and they brought it all to Grothy.
They really did. And you're gonna see multiple penalties on this play. I think one near where the ball was, one away from the ball. There was a little bit of a scuffle with Nick Reed from Oregon involved with one of the offensive linemen for South Florida. It was Jared Carnes.
Personal foul, hands to the face. Defense, number 49, penalized 15 yards, automatic first down.
Oh boy, that's a big one, 15 and an automatic first. That's four personal fouls whistled here in the opening quarter. That's 10 flags.
It's unbelievable. I've never seen this many personal fouls so early in a ball game.
The penalty is enforced half the distance to the goal from the previous spot. Half the distance to the goal, automatic first down.
Well, Nick Reed and Jared Carnes were mixed up and gotten under each other's skins a little bit, and Nick Reed went to the head, went to the face, and that is a no-no. You can't go up under a guy's helmet, try and drive home a point to him, and Nick Reed, unfortunately for him, got caught that time.
Third personal foul called on Oregon here on the quarter as we're under 2 minutes, and South Florida on the move inside the 15-yard line with fresh downs. Grothy, handoff. A little stop and go by Benjamin Williams. And a number of Oregon Ducks in on that stop.
And another late flag.
Wow. Holding. And so the Bulls will have to go back the other way. That's 11 flags in the quarter. I know that does not please.
Number 88. Offense, penalized 10 yards from the end of the run. Repeat first down.
That's Quincy Oakley. He's the one that had that big catch a few plays ago down the middle of the field. One thing you don't want to do when you're a young player, you don't get an opportunity to play very much, as in Quincy Oakley. Doesn't have many plays this year. Go and you make a good one, make a good positive impression, then you come out and you make a bad play, block somebody in the back. It kind of just tarnishes what you've already accomplished.
And the head coach Jim Leavitt gives him the hook.
Yeah, that's the problem right there.
First and 17 now at the 22-yard line of Oregon. Grothy throws incomplete.
Another flag.
My goodness, two, three, four.
Did you throw your flag on that one, too?
Hold on, let me grab it. It's in my left pocket. Look at that. Looks like you and I after dinner.
Pass interference. Defense. Number 34. First down at the spot of the foul.
Oh, that's A.J. Tuatelli.
You're going to see right there. A.J. Tuatelli, he knows he can't do that. I mean, you can't stick out that big arm and just stop a man from cutting across your face. He got you in a good advantageous position for him to beat you on the slant route. I guess it's better than giving up a touchdown pass. Go ahead and give up the holding penalty, but don't look like he didn't do anything. That's what he reacted like, he didn't do anything wrong.
It's the who, me look.
Yeah, what, me?
First and 10, 47 ticks left on the first quarter clock. It's time to ball at the 14-yard line. Grothy pushes forward for a couple, and one, two, three, four, five ducks in on the tackle.
Matt Grothy, he's one of only two quarterbacks in the country to rush for over 800 yards and throw for over 2,400 yards. You know who the other one is? He won the Heisman Trophy.
Ah.
Tim Tebow.
Yes.
Good company right there.
Very good company.
Not very often you see that combination of running and passing.
Well, you won't see too many 14-play drives, but this is the 14th play for the Bulls. And the first quarter clock running down to six, down to five. The snap is away. Grothy in the shotgun all day to throw. Now, flush down to the pocket. Watch out. Got it away. Incomplete the call, ending a wild first half.
Well, you're a young quarterback, Matt Grothy, a sophomore. You've got to have a clock in your head. I know you trust yourself. You trust yourself moving around back there. Look how long he's holding this ball. And at some point, you got to realize there's a very big man in Cole Linehan coming very close to you. You can't turn back and give yourself up like that. That's going to cost you. It's going to take a toll on you. Cole Linehan just saying, please turn back into me. Give me a chance to rip your head off. And he does it right there.
Well, that ends the first quarter in El Paso. Oregon with the 8-0 lead. The 74th annual Brute Sun Bowl on CBS will continue after this message and a word from your local station. Oregon with the 8-0 lead on South Florida as we start the second quarter. And MetLife is teaming up with CBS to provide today's aerial coverage of all the football action down below. A fixed wing aircraft is being used today, so blimp Snoopy 1 and Snoopy 2 can remain in a little warmer weather. Yeah, Snoopy 1, Snoopy 2, they like that South Florida or California weather a little bit better. But it's a nice day in El Paso, Texas.
The sun is shining in El Paso, that's for sure. And Matt Grothy, he's got to be careful here. He's had a history this year in their losses of turning the ball over. He turned it over in the red zone against UConn and also against Cincinnati. You don't want to give up points here.
Third down and 8, shotgun. Grothy steps up, fires up top, tapped and dropped. At the 1 yard line, oh, Jamar Taylor, the freshman, looking at 6.
That really was a good throw. Matt Grothy made a good, quick decision. He saw that he had coverage beaten on the outside with Jamar Taylor. He had him open on the side, put it on a rope, and got it to him before Patrick Chung could get over there and make the play. And Grothy, he says, I can't put it any better for you, my man. Jamar, you got to make that catch. And as we said, Craig, it's important to score touchdowns when you get in the red zone. A field goal, that's a positive, but you come off the field kind of feeling like you let down your teammates.
Alvarado, 17 of 27, his longest of 47, boots this one up and through, a chip shot from 27. And the Bulls of South Florida on the board, 8-3 Oregon. Welcome back to the 74th Sun Bowl. Craig Bowler, Jack, Steve Berline, 8-3 our score. Oregon and South Florida. We saw 11 penalties in the opening quarter. A lot of physical play, personal fouls. Is this just 30 days off kind of football?
Well, it all goes into it. The bottom line is that neither one of these teams have really settled down and gotten into the real kind of game that they like to play. These are both coaches that emphasize discipline and composure and poise. We haven't seen a lot of that to this point yet. I believe the team that settles down quickest will be the team that gets control of this football game.
All right, so it's 8-3 early, and Oregon with that lead. 14:49 to play as we get set to kick it away. Alvarado, officially a 29-yard field goal. And Tichy has it teed up and to kick away at the 30-yard line. Kicking into the wind, and a good kick. Driving Chong back at the goal line. He's at the 15-20, breaks a tackle. And another flag down at the 32-yard line. A flag at the 32.
There is a penalty marker on the field.
What is the all-time record for most flags in a game?
We may find out before the day's out.
We might find out before halftime.
Holding. On the return team.
During the return, holding. Number 13, penalized 10 yards from the end of the run. First down, Oregon.
So Oregon will start. And let's go downstairs and check in with Sam Ryan.
That's right, Craig. Oregon back out on offense. And hey, at 6'6", Justin Roper certainly has the height to play basketball. In fact, it was his father who talked him into switching to football over basketball. He said, you know what, at 6'6", there are plenty of basketball players who are that height, but not too many 6'6" quarterbacks. He actually played in Georgia against Greg Oden, the Portland Trailblazers' number one pick. He said, wow, he was a force back then in eighth, ninth grade. You always knew where he was, Craig.
Yeah, Sam, you know, 6'6", 205, and Justin Roper told us yesterday, I'm trying to put on weight, guys. I'm trying. I'll eat 2.5 steaks, and I'll lose a pound.
He said that actually did happen. Amazing. And I'll tell you, we need to point out, too, his dad was a football coach, is a football coach.
Down at
Georgia Tech, yeah. So maybe there was a little bit of dad maybe kind of saying, I'd love my son to be a quarterback, too. And he's done a pretty darn good job of it as well.
Yeah, Roper saw his first football game when he was 2 weeks old. Stewart on this drive is eating up South Florida's defense. Breaks through to the 44-yard line. Stewart has that big play ability, Steve. Nearly 6 yards a carry and ran for nearly 1,500 yards during the regular season.
He's a fantastic running back. Voted by the coaches to the All-American team along with Darren McFadden. But Oregon doing a really good job of spreading out the field, creating lanes for Jonathan Stewart to get up in there.
6 carries, 49 yards. The keeper, Roper, lost it. Batupu, the left tackle, number 57. Well, I tell you, Roper's lucky Tupu was there to cover up the fumble.
Well, Mike Bellotti did not make any bones about it. He said, this kid is a pretty darn good athlete. Moves well for 6'6", but he's not Dennis Dixon, and we're going to be careful with how we have him run the football. We've got to have him do a little bit, but he won't do much more if he keeps putting the ball on the ground.
Stewart waits for a couple of blockers and then finds that seam. And 1, 2, 3, 4, Bulls bring down Jonathan Stewart. Oh, he's a big man. Goes about 230, 235.
He's sneaky big.
Yeah.
You know, he sits down in the room and he doesn't look like a huge back, but then when he stands up, you say, boy, this guy's got a little beef on him, 235 pounds.
I knew he was tough when he shook my hand. There's that misdirection we saw in the opening quarter, and outside goes Andre Crenshaw, and boy, he delivers the blow and then takes one himself and is dropped out of bounds after a big gain to the 18-yard line.
Well, that very easily could have been a little bit of a late hit as well on South Florida. Get a little frustrated. I don't think they're used to having this many successful running plays against them. You're going to see a huge lane created right there for Crenshaw down the side. I think there aren't many running backs who could not have gotten through that lane right there, but he does a good job of bouncing it in and then bouncing it back outside and finishes off a very nice gain for the Ducks.
A 28-yard pickup. And now Oregon on the front porch trying to add to the 8-3 lead here in El Paso.
That was something that Chip Kelly, the offensive coordinator, told us. He said, this is a very good defense we're playing. We're going to try and spread them out, create natural lanes, and they've attacked them very well to this point.
This time, the Bulls converge and will not let loose of Jonathan Stewart. And, Steve, when you look at the defensive stats for the Bulls of South Florida, they rank number 3 in the Big East against the run, only giving up 112 yards of ball game.
That's very, very true. And they've done a great job this year of shutting down big-name running backs. You know, Steve Slayton and Pat White for West Virginia combined for only 90 yards. And then Kevin Smith from Central Florida, who averages 188 yards a game, he had 55 yards total.
Roper up top and overthrows. Oh, he just showed what type of arm he has. That is a great motion from the young quarterback. And when we talked to Mike Bellotti yesterday, he said, listen, I had to make a decision whether I start Cody Kemp or Justin Roper. Roper's the most athletic, also possesses the strongest arm.
And those are two pretty good qualities to have, too. He's 6'6". He is a redshirt freshman. He's been in the system this last month, Bellotti said, has really helped him because he's now getting the reps that he's never gotten before.
Third down and 14 with a slip pass, and Jeff Mail took it high and low. My goodness, South Florida can put the pads on you.
That was a serious pop right there. I think Ben Moffitt, the middle linebacker, right in the middle of it, as you would expect, trying to get that little jailbreak screen set up out there where you pop it to the receiver real quick, get the lineman out there trying to pick off people. Not working against this very, very athletic South Florida defense.
Evenson, 14 of 18 on the season, his longest of 47. This will be from 39 with the wind behind him. And Evenson knocks in three. Oregon opens up an 11-3 lead on the Bulls of South Florida. CBS Sports presentation of the Brute Sun Bowl is sponsored by the Home Depot. You can do it, we can help. Bud Light, endless refreshment from start to finish. Bud Light keeps it coming. And by Red Lobster. Try all your big favorites during the big seafood festival right now at Red Lobster. And welcome back to El Paso, Oregon, with the 11-3 lead on South Florida. Let's check out the Bulls' key wins this season. They had plenty of up and down, and September 8th, the Bulls traveled to Auburn, scored a stunning upset over the Tigers, winning 26-23 in OT. 3 weeks later, national TV audience at home, the Bulls beat their conference rival, West Virginia, 21-13. And then following the three straight losses in the middle of the season, the Bulls won their last three, including that blowout over Louisville in Tampa.
Well, and Jim Leavitt told us the thing he's most proud of this football team. You talk about the great wins. They had several of those. You just pointed them out. But how they responded to the three losses, to Rutgers, to Cincinnati, and they come back, and then UConn, and they were able to right the ship, and that's what he's most proud of. These guys were able to stop the bleeding, get themselves back on the winning ways, and then have a chance to set an all-time record with 10 wins for the University of South Florida.
Now they finish off the regular season, winning their last three, as you mentioned, in that 48-37 win at Pitt. Boy, another deep kick, and there'll be no return. Evenson showing his strong leg, and South Florida will start at their own 20-yard line. Well, Wednesday, Dave's back, and all new for the new year. Don't miss the return of the Late Show with Dave. Dave welcomes Robin Williams. Oh, that should be fun. All new starting Wednesday on CBS. Hard to believe, Mr. Berline, 08 is around the corner.
Very hard to believe. Very hard to believe, but I'm excited about 08. No reason to be down in the dumps about it yet.
A good football game here on New Year's afternoon. New Year's Eve afternoon, 12:08 to play second quarter in El Paso. 11-3, Oregon. And South Florida back on the offense at their own 20-yard line. Last time they had the football, Alvarado kicked a 29-yard field goal. Oh, near interception by Walter Thurman III. Four picks on the year, and number five was right on his hands.
Yeah, that's a prime example of what Nick Aliotti, the defensive coordinator for Oregon, told us they were going to do early in this game, and even said almost to a fault, we're going to put a bunch of people up in there and try and put pressure on Matt Grothy. Don't let him get going with his feet running the ball. We're going to try and put pressure on him, and hopefully they won't make any plays early in the game. And right there, Oregon almost made a big play going the other way.
Now, Grothy's been picked 12 times this season. He's dodged the bullet a couple of times here in the first half. He wants to throw again, slingshots it across the middle again in traffic, but the catch is made by Hester. Jesse Hester Jr. out of Belleglade, Florida. Yeah, Grothy again throws that ball around. Taurus Johnson gets his share. Hester, Carlton Mitchell. Cedric Hill, the tight end, also with 20 grabs on the year. That brings up third down and two, under 12 minutes to play in the half. Flag. Tukafu, number 39, saw a little movement because he put Jared Carnes right on his back.
False start. Number 70, penalized 5 yards. Remains third down.
Yeah, Tukafu better be careful, though, too. You come up and you pop a guy like that for no reason. That was a pretty solid blow he just gave to Carnes over there. Look at the most combined penalties in Sun Bowl history, 18, three times. We're 14 today, halfway through the second quarter. Not even halfway through the second quarter.
No.
4 minutes into it.
I think you can write it down. New bowl record's going to be set today with penalties. Third down and seven.
Grothy, shotgun, two-step drop, sets up those feet, throws a wobbler, and it's caught. Torres Johnson able to grab that ball, that wobbling ball at the 35-yard line.
Well, Torres Johnson is one of those guys that the coaching staff said he is the key to our offense. It may not show up in the numbers, but guess who was missing during those three losses, that three loss stretch? The one guy that was missing was Torres Johnson. He comes back in, and they start winning again, finishing up the season with three straight wins. He's a big receiver over the middle. He can do a lot of different things, gives him a lot of versatility, and he makes him a very good offense.
Now Grothy on the snap, takes it, tucks it, picks up a couple three, and is hit down hard at the 37-yard line. Now getting back to Torres for a moment, he hurt that ankle against Rutgers, and that forced him out for those three games. And you're right, it took away really a spread offense for South Florida.
Yeah, you take away one vital part, and especially a senior with experience like Torres Johnson, a guy that they really rely on to play different positions inside, controlling the middle of the field. Now you're going with a younger player who's maybe not as experienced, and you just lose the ability to use all your creativity.
Four wide receivers on second down and 8-3 stacked up top. Grothy looks flushed out of the pocket. This is where he's dangerous. Tries a stiff arm, and Oregon closes down that corner. Now another flag is dropped.
That's penalty number 15, and you know what it is, Craig. It's a personal foul for a late hit on Matt Grothy.
Dead ball. Personal foul. Late hit. Helmet contact. Number 30. Penalized 15 yards. Automatic first down.
That's Ajamon, the middle linebacker.
And Nick Eliotti told us, he said, we are going to be focused on Matt Grothy. We will know when he's running the football. Watch here. He's down. Boom. Just a little bit late. Not too much. He hit the helmet. He came in late, but he did try to avoid him, but did make a little contact with the helmet. Could it be a little bit questionable? Maybe so, but that's the way the rule is. You hit the helmet, you're going to throw the flag, especially if it's late.
Grothy, the handoff. Mike Ford throwing ducks all around, and another flag. I tell you, Steve, I'll be honest. Bill Algie's having a tough time, this crew from the Mid-American Conference, doing their best just to try to control the emotions on that football field right now.
Well, they definitely are, but I think we've also seen signs of maybe a little bit of overkill on the referee's part, too, and I'm not criticizing. I'm just saying.
Holding, number 71, offense, penalized 10 yards from the previous spot, repeat first down.
There comes a time where you want to let these guys play a little bit of football, too. And sure, these are all legitimate penalties. You could throw a penalty on every play if you really want to in any level, in college, high school, NFL. It's just a matter of determining when the line is drawn.
Now that brings up first down and 20. And the clock under 10 minutes left in the half. Grothy, shotgun, sets up the slip screen. Oh, ho, ho. Did you hear the pads once again? Kevin Garrett.
Benjamin Williams.
Let's hear what it sounds like to catch Kevin Garrett right in the mouth.
Textbook tackle, head up, right on the numbers.
Man, he sniffed out that screen pass perfectly. And Benjamin Williams was in the unenviable position of receiving that shot. Great play by Garrett.
Well, the Bulls come out and really spread the field now with a five wide receiver set. Second down. Little pitch and catch just right across the middle. And that's Courtney Denson, a senior from Miami, with the grab. And I don't see a flag. No. I think that's a clean play at the 45-yard line.
Yes.
Third down and 18. Grothy's numbers today, 7 of 14 for 64 yards. Grothy. In traffic, dodges trouble at the 50, to the 45, 40, to the 35, to the 32-yard line. The biggest run of the day, and the legs got Grothy out of trouble.
That is Matt Grothy at his best. Oregon coming with pressure off the right side, the top of your screen. Matt Grothy is one of the few quarterbacks that can find a way to get out of there. He knows, he trusts himself, he's got the speed to run away from defensive players that most quarterbacks can't, and he makes them pay. You got to know where this guy is on the field. When you get a chance to make the tackle, you got to bring him down.
He held that ball a little dangerous in that right hand, didn't turn it to his left and tuck. Grothy throws to the air, it's complete. And Hester with another reception. And Steve, he holds the career rushing record for quarterbacks in South Florida. Look at the numbers around the NCAA this season. Grothy with over 1,000.
Those are pretty good running quarterbacks right there. And it just shows you this guy is a run weapon. He doesn't run only when things break down. They design runs for him because he's so good at it.
Nearly 4.5 yards per carry. That's just unheard of for a quarterback. As Grothy stands in the pocket, flushed, looking downfield, looking, throws it away. Incomplete pass, stops the clock with 7:13 to play.
And it just puts so much pressure. You got to give credit to the Oregon defense, how they've not given up a big play in the passing game yet. When Matt Grothy gets out on the edge, we talked to Jairus Byrd about that yesterday in our meeting with him, and he said, well, a couple times during this bowl practice, your instinct tells you to come up and try and make a play on the quarterback, and he was burned a couple times in practice. He said he will not drop coverage until he's 100% sure that Matt Grothy has crossed the line of scrimmage.
Well, we've seen some long drives in this first half. The 10th play of this drive coming for South Florida. Grothy, pressure. Wiggles out of trouble. Still on his feet, throws. Complete! Touchdown! Can you believe it?
Well, that is all Matt Grothy. What can you say about that? There are not many men that could elude the grasp of a guy the size of David Fa'atete, who had him for he had him dead to rights in the backfield for an 8-yard loss. Grothy spins out of it, finds wide open down the sideline for a touchdown.
Grothy's 14th toss of the season, fourth touchdown catch of the year for Johnson, and now the Bulls will go for two to try this game in El Paso. Three wide receivers, top of your screen, two down below from the shotgun. Grothy throws, we're tied! Cedric Hill picks up two for the Bulls. So Cedric Hill from Grothy and tucks that ball in safely, and that ties this game at 11.
Timeout.
And the touchdown, great escape by Grothy to find Taurus Johnson.
What can you say about the individual effort? Matt Grothy to Taurus Johnson. Right here, tucking it, doesn't know whether he's gonna run or not. Look, Fa'atete thinks he's got him. No way. That's 8 points for South Florida.
Oh, Grothy, yes, we're tied at 11. The 74 Sun Bowl on CBS. Time now for the Home Depot's Tool for Success.
Well, we said that Oregon has got to take away Matt Grothy's wheels. They didn't do it on that drive. The big run, picking up the 3rd and 18, and then eluding the tackle, David Fa'atete. He finds Taurus Johnson for the touchdown after breaking contain. That is what Oregon is going to be paying the price for all day unless they find a way to corral Mr. Matt Grothy right there.
11 plays, 80 yards, just over 8 minutes off the clock. And Grothy is Houdini. A couple of escapes there on that drive, and we are tied at 11.
Now, I'm not 100% sold on his hairdo yet. It still hasn't grown on me yet. What do you think?
If he picks up a Sun Bowl win, I think it's going to be in vogue in Tampa.
It might already be in Tampa.
7:04 to play.
A fantastic fantastic individual effort on his part to get his team out of a bad situation, make some plays, and that's the lift that Jim Leavitt was hoping for this USF team.
Sold-out crowd here at the Sun Bowl in El Paso, enjoying it just a sky blue day. 11-all, 25th-ranked South Florida against Oregon. And Justin Tichy will tee it up at the 30-yard line. We have seen big plays, we have seen penalties, and just halfway through the second quarter, take a breath for a moment.
In true Sun Bowl form, though, we've got ourselves a good football game.
Teach you the kick at the 4-yard line. And pushed out at the 25. And again, I don't see a flag on that return. So they come off the pile clean.
Well, this is the point in the ball game now. Oregon has been sitting on the sideline, the Oregon offense, for a long time. This South Florida defense should come out energized, refresh their offense, just put a big score on the board to get them back into this ball game. I expect to see the South Florida defense out there flying around this series. Be interesting to see how Justin Roper and the Oregon Ducks handle that.
Roper's numbers, 7 of 11 for 66 yards. Roper with a touchdown toss in the first quarter. Stewart works his way to the near side, driven out of bounds. And there's a flag. 1, 2, I count 3. And that will be another personal foul in this ball game, and I count 6 so far called in the first half.
I just don't see that. That one right there, I can honestly tell you, I'm watching the whole time right here like you are, and Jarrett Bowie, I don't think he did anything wrong out of bounds. He didn't throw him down inside. Sure, they were running with each other, and Jonathan Stewart went down.
Well, a busy first half for this crew from the Mid-American Conference, led by Bill Algie. And I think you're right. I think there was something about above the pads, above the shoulder pads. You start getting involved, Steve, with the horse collar, yeah. or grabbing the helmet or the face mask. You got some issues.
Well, nothing good is going to come from any kind of contact out of bounds. Any kind of contact at all after the play is over, generally speaking, it's not going to lead to anything good happening for your team. I didn't see anything really bad that Jarrett Bowie did, but
there are 3 dead ball fouls on the play.
Oh my.
Dead ball, personal foul, late hit. Dead ball, personal foul, late hit. And dead ball, personal foul, late hit. Those penalties offset. It'll be second down.
Just too many penalties to enforce one right there. 3 different late hits on that play.
You see some of the frustration on that Oregon sideline. Mike Bellotti. 13 years, he's seen a lot of football. I don't know if I've seen 3 personal fouls on one particular play in a long time. Second down, 5 after they unravel it. Ducks back on the attack. Stewart cuts through to the 37.
Stewart, number 28, carries to the 38.
Well, I'll tell you what, Craig, as we got a player down for South Florida, back up there.
32, Carlton Williams.
Mike Jenkins.
If South Florida doesn't figure out a way to stop that underneath handoff to Stewart, where they're really trying to get wide and creating a lane wide outside around the number area, both sides, it's obvious that Oregon's going to keep running that play, as any good football team would. If you can't stop, we're going to keep running it.
Well, 126 yards so far against one of the better run defenses in the Big East. And there's another big gain to the 47-yard line.
And that's the same play again. The back obviously saw the hole up inside. Did not get it as wide as they have run it for the past quarter and a half. But he's got the freedom, if he sees green grass, obviously, to take it up there and get what they can get.
Second down in a short 1 as the clock runs up on 6 minutes. There's a box snap. And Roper has to cover up at the 40-yard line. Let's go downstairs and check in with Sam Ryan.
Yeah, Ben Moffitt in the South Florida defense trying to slow Oregon. Now, Ben Moffitt, a leader in the defense. He's called a throwback player, but he's got a full plate. He has two kids. He's married. His children are 3 and 5 years old. He actually, his day starts at 6 in the morning. He gets the kids up off to school. Then he has to drive 55 miles to the South Florida campus. His day doesn't end until 9 p.m. He's been working his whole life. His family owns a tree business, so he's been out there since he was 8 years old, guys.
Sam, thanks. Great work ethic, and love the chat with Ben Moffitt yesterday. He says, hey, you know what? I've worked since I was 8. Football's fun. This isn't work. This is fun. We got another flag down on that play, holding the call against Oregon. You know, Ben Moffitt, an impressive guy, a senior, 100 tackles on the season, and all the work he's put in, he does it on the field as well. And he was honored as an All-Big East first-team selection this season.
Yeah, and he's a legitimate NFL prospect, too. I think that all the NFL scouts rate him very highly and put him as a high draft choice, one of the top two or three linebackers and middle linebackers in the country.
Yeah, sleep's a rarity at his house. Roper ropes one down the middle, tipped incomplete.
And that's one of those balls. Justin Roper just trying to make a play, third and long. Can't fault him for that anyway. You know, if they intercept it back down there, it's going to be like a short punt. But generally speaking, when you throw a ball up over the middle like that against a good aggressive defense like South Florida and that receiver's not open, you might pay the price.
Josh Sirey back to punt at the 21-yard line. Marcus Edwards set to return for South Florida. Long snap, good snap, and away she goes. Boy, great punt back at the 10-yard line. And you can still hear those pads. They are hitting out there at the Sun Bowl in El Paso. Well, on that sideline, a very emotional Jim Leavitt in his 11th year. Built South Florida from the bottom up. And we're tied at 11 against Oregon. Now, the state of the Florida, the Big Four. Well, that's what Leavitt would like, that South Florida gains that type of respect to join the ranks of Florida. Florida State in Miami and South Florida in the Sun Bowl. The Gators in the Capital One and the Seminoles in the Music City Bowl. Rough year for the Miami Hurricanes. But Jim Leavitt wants that program recognized and respected.
That's his dream. You know, it's always been the Big Three, but the South Florida Bulls are the only team that has beaten three conference championships this year. They've established themselves three straight bowl games, possible 10-win season, and a big play right here.
Berthy on the play action, rolls out, hooks up with Cedric Hill, and Walter Thurman the third brings him down. But right now the Bulls in a bit of a groove.
They seem to be finding their rhythm a little bit. And sure, last drive, a lot of it was due to the individual abilities of Matt Grothy. But even throughout that drive, when there weren't penalties, the South Florida team looked like they were starting to get some rhythm out there. And right there, a nice misdirection bootleg play. Good pickup to Cedric Hill.
Grothy, 10 of 18 passing, 110 yards. Clock continues to run, 4.5 minutes. Fakes the handoff. Again, good protection, and then on his back foot throws it away. Incomplete. Well, coming up on the Geico Halftime Report, we'll take a look at some of the great moments in the SEC this year and have the story of a legendary quarterback who fulfilled a lifelong dream. Stay tuned for the Geico Halftime Report. Sam Ryan will bring it to you. Second down and 10 with 4:23 to play in the half. Grothy almost exclusively today from the shotgun. He's gone under center on occasion, but has bought him some time. There's that escapability. Sets up, throws in double coverage. And this time, oh, it's in and out of the hands. Incomplete. Thurman had the ball, dropped it.
Ball was thrown deep to Jason Sherman down the field. Very, very easily could have been intercepted. Thurman was in great position. Really hard to look back and turn her body around and find that football and judge it properly. But Thurman almost pulled it off. Not a very good throw by Matt Grothy there.
And Steve, Jason Sherman, number one, had to become a defensive back. You notice he had to reach back and try to bat that ball away. And it saved Grothy and the interception. Third down and 10. Five wide receivers. The Bulls spread it. Again, the throw in traffic and incomplete. Grothy has flirted with interceptions all day long.
And you play with fire, you're going to get burned. That's my motto there. That was a great job by Jairus Byrd, the corner, trying to bait Matt Grothy into throwing that ball to Cedric Hill. He timed it up perfectly, was very patient, and Matt Grothy almost bit on it enough to where it was picked off. Very fortunate that it wasn't.
Alvarado for his third punt of the afternoon. Jairus Byrd set to return back inside his own 20-yard line. Another good kick. High, high hanger, turns it over. And that ball floats out of bounds. They'll mark it at the 23-yard line. 4:01 to play in the half. A 34-yard punt. And we'll be back. Welcome back. 4:01 to play, first half. I see a little heat coming off the field here in El Paso. The Sun Bowl, 74th edition, and 40 years on CBS. Penalties, but few turnovers. 17 in all here in the first half. Justin Roper in the shotgun. Takes the handoff, goes up top. That ball falls incomplete. And Ed Dixon was there, but had to wait just an extra beat for that pass.
Yeah, it was one of those throws. Could have been out there a little bit better from Justin Roper, but the key for Oregon is that they have not made the bad plays. They had a chance right there to maybe make a big play. Roper underthrew that a little bit, but they didn't pay the price. It was not a bad decision. You got to take shots like that to keep a defense honest.
Second down and 10, and Stewart stood up around the 28-yard line. And Jonathan Stewart, he finds a little wiggle room. Watch out.
Well, there was a little question about how effective he'd be today. I think he's been pretty darn effective, in my opinion. Look at that. No signs of the turf toe problem. Coach Bellotti worried about him not getting enough practice time, maybe his conditioning, but Jonathan Stewart putting those worries to bed with one good run after another to both sides of the field. There goes another one.
11 carries for 71. Tack on a few more. Will they catch him? Stewart! Touchdown, Ducks! 72 yards. You blink an eye and he's gone.
Well, you talk about the man and he comes through. Nothing fancy about that one, Craig. Just the same play they've been running all day. That South Florida is going to get sick of it. They probably already are.
That touchdown breaks an 11-all tie. And the point after by Evenson to come. 11th touchdown on the season for Jonathan Stewart. And the big fella just proved that he can run. He's got a motor, 71 yards officially. Jonathan Stewart.
Look at that seam. Look at the lane. And you get a guy like that up in the defensive backfield that easily without having to make a move. What do you expect?
71 yards. The Ducks by 7. Oregon 18, South Florida 11. How about a 44-second drive And that happens when you get a 71-yard touchdown run by Jonathan Stewart. And Steve, today, 12 carries, 142 yards, the ninth 100-yard game for Stewart on the season.
Well, this is a team that kind of thrives and makes it a habit to score quickly, too, Craig. With the previous games, out of their 53 scoring drives, 22 of them, 53 touchdown drives, 22 of them have resulted in touchdowns in less than 90 seconds. So real high percentage of quick strike scores. That right there is another great example of it.
So the Ducks with the lead, set to kick off. Evenson has it teed up at the 30-yard line. Murphy and Johnson set to return for South Florida. Good kick. 6 yards deep, no return. Murphy takes the knees. And tomorrow, Graham Harrell leads the high-scoring Red Raiders of Texas Tech against Chris Long and the Virginia Cavaliers and the Konica Minolta Gator Bowl. That's tomorrow, 1 Eastern, right here on CBS. Mr. Lundquist and Mr. Danielson will have that call for you.
And you mentioned Chris Long, the son of one Howie Long, a former teammate of mine with the Los Angeles Raiders, now a Hall of Famer. We've got a player down on the field here. But Chris Long for Virginia, one of the very, very best defensive ends in the country, going to be a tremendous professional player as well.
Now we got a bull down. Now you speak of Chris Long, that defensive end from Virginia, 2007 Hendricks Award winner, ACC Defensive Player of the Year. Sure, Howie very proud of what his son has accomplished. We'll step aside, 3:17 to play in El Paso. Good to see Richard Kelly able to walk off the field with no help, the freshman from Bushnell, Florida. Had to shake the cobwebs out a little bit. So 3:17 to play first half. Oregon with the 7-point lead, and South Florida will start this drive at their own 20-yard line. Matt Grothy from the shotgun. Looks near side. Now throws it up top. Got a man open. And it's caught in traffic at the 47. How about that catch? Dontavia Bogan, the freshman, with a couple of grabs on the afternoon.
Well, for a minute, I thought Matt Grothy was going to not see Bogan up the seam. He was open for a while. There was a little bit of a bust in the coverage, and definitely Red got to it and was able to convert that throw before Matthew Harper was over there to make the tackle. Great job of taking advantage of a little bit of a blown coverage there.
Under 3 minutes to play, first half. First and 10, Bulls. Grothy sets and fires. It's caught out of bounds. That stops the clock. Jesse Hester Jr. So the passing game for Grothy working right now against Oregon's defense. Grothy today. Steve, now you can appreciate this. I'm sure your wide receivers did. 8 different wide receivers making grabs today.
Well, there are certain wide receivers that wouldn't appreciate that, the ones who want the ball thrown to them every time.
Hey, Steve Berline, I want it every time. That's what they told you in the huddle, right?
That's right. But it's very consistent. It's what he's done all year, spread the ball around. And you can see the improvement since that first quarter.
South Florida on the move, first and 10 at the Oregon 37-yard line. 3 wideouts, near side. Grothy tucks and runs. Little stutter step, 35, and slides to the 30. That play typifies Grothy's ability to run. And Steve, what I mean by that, you don't get a clean hit on him. He slides through and then takes the knee when he has to.
And then that's what the coaching staff told us. You know, you worry about this guy if he's going to hold up over time. And he said, well, you know, I would if he took a lot of hits. He finds a way to, Jim Leavitt said, he finds a way to get up in there, make his yards, and does not take unnecessary hits.
195 total yards for Grothy today. The stop and go. Ho, ho. I don't know if we've seen a game together, my friend. How many hard hits Jerome Boyd and Garrett, I think maybe Boyd was the first to put a pad on him, but they are hitting today.
Yeah, Garrett is the one that made the big hit earlier when we let you hear what it sounded like on the field. Right there, he finishes off that play again. He's bringing some pop, but I think there's a lot of people in those green jerseys out there that are ready to finish off some tackles today.
Well, they stack it up on that line. 9 in the box on short, 3rd and short. Everybody trying to push the pile, and a flag is down. Oregon stacked the box knowing that South Florida was going to try to push it forward for a short one-yard gain, and a flag's down.
Well, there was nobody in Oregon green that had any doubt in their mind who was going to run that football. They knew Matt Grothy was going to try and run the quarterback sneak. It all comes down to the spot and then also, of course, the penalty.
Oregon tried to anticipate the snap.
Offside. Defense. Number 99 lined up in the neutral zone. The penalty will resolve it. A first down.
So an automatic first down as Jeremy Gibbs jumps. Actually lined up in the neutral zone. And that flag ties the Sun Bowl record with 18 combined penalties in the first half.
And that's a penalty that really there's no excuse for. You can look in and see whether you're offside. The ball's right next to you.
Grothy from the shotgun. Steps up, fires. And Cedric Hill makes another grab. And another collision by Oregon's defenders. One, two, three, four put a hit on Cedric Hill. Harper and Boyd again leading the way. Yeah.
They've really found something, it seems, at least in the way Matt Grothy is trying to get the ball to Cedric Hill. They like the matchup on the inside. When they spread the field, they really feel like he's got the desirable matchup gone to him several times.
Hill a good target at 6'3", 230, first and 10. Bulls now go to the ground, and to the 11-yard line goes Mike Ford.
Number 26, Mike Ford carries to the 10.
Ford averaging 4.8 yards a carry coming in, and there's a timeout call by Jim Leavitt.
Timeout.
57 seconds to play. The Bulls trying to find the end zone before the break. Oregon with the 18-11 lead, but South Florida trying to push in for the tie. You look at the timeouts remaining. The Bulls with one. The Ducks have needed three timeouts remaining with 57 seconds left to play. And Grothy, once again, shotgun. Barks out the calls. Pressure from the ends. Dodges pressure. Now slings it up high in the corner. Incomplete. Amari Jackson, the intended receiver. And Patrick Chung, that rover who has that linebacker mentality, was back on coverage. And I saw him shaking that head, said, nope, not this time, not on me. Not on me.
He said he liked Patrick Chung told us, number one, it's obvious he loves football, but he told us that he loves to talk and stir it up out there every chance he gets. He's a tremendous player. First team all Pac-10 right there made a great play.
His favorite line, you're ugly.
You're ugly. And this Oregon defense, again, standing up in the red zone.
Third down and eight. Five wide receivers. There was a jump. Grothy. Oh, puts it down as he stumbled on the turf here at the Sun Bowl. Kenny Rowe bringing pressure, and Grothy stumbled and put the ball on the turf.
I'll tell you what, that's just great red zone defense. There's a reason why a team is great playing in the red zone. It's because it's emphasis on it by the coaching staff. You're going to see all the way across back here, you're going to see nothing but green jerseys, patient in their position, not allowing anybody to influence them out of those zones. Look at all the green jerseys in there. There's not anybody open in that end zone. Just a fantastic job of playing defense. And Matt Grothy had plenty of time to make a play, just nobody was open.
South Florida will call the timeout as the clock ran down to four. And so they'll use their final timeout of the half as they set for a field goal. So in comes Delbert Alvarado, who made a 29-yard kick earlier to start the second quarter. Interesting first half. Oregon goes to the sideline for a quick talk. Penalties, big plays. Jonathan Stewart's 71-yard run to put the Ducks on top.
Puts him at over 140 on the day in the first half. Now, interesting that Oregon would take a timeout and spend as much time as they did with their defense over there on the sideline, you might want to look for some kind of an interesting block attempt by the Oregon Ducks.
This will be a 35-yard attempt near hash mark.
And it should be pointed out, too. Another timeout by Oregon.
They're going to try to freeze Alvarado.
Oregon.
They had three
their
to use.
Timeout.
And Alvarado and the University of South Florida have had three field goals blocked this year. So that's something that I guarantee you Mike Bellotti is thinking about. These guys have given up three blocked field goals. Let's try and see if we can get number four right here.
Alvarado now 18 of 28 attempts on the season. That's a great point. You put the deep freeze, or at least you're trying to put the deep freeze on Alvarado.
And I don't think there are many, if any, teams in the NCAA that have given up more than three blocked field goals, or even more than one or two. If that happens once or twice during the season, the coach is upset. Three times and it's a problem.
Four seconds on the clock. 35-yard attempt. Good snap. The hold is down. The kick is away. And good from 35. Alvarado from 35 yards out. That closes out the first half here at the Sun Bowl. 18-14. And the redshirt freshman, Roper, has led the Ducks to a four-point advantage at the break.
Well, I'll tell you, it's going to be interesting to see what happens in the second half. The one thing that South Florida has to do, they've got to find a way to shut down that running game of Oregon.
Let's go downstairs. Here's Sam Ryan.
Mike Bellotti, Jonathan Stewart gave you guys a lead, but Justin Roper getting his first start. What's your assessment of his play today?
I think he's played very well. I was pleased. I thought he made tremendous improvement over the course of this bowl practice session. I'm really pleased. And again, we felt we could run the ball. I wish we'd play a little bit more poise on both sides of the ball because we're one of the least penalized teams in the nation in our conference, but it's not happened for us today. We have to play with a little bit more poise in the second half.
Thank you, Mike. Craig, back
thanks.
To you.
All right. Thanks a lot, Sam. That ends the first half with a score. Oregon leading South Florida 18-14. Sam Ryan will be back with a Geico halftime report after this message and a word from your local station.
CBS Sports presents the Geico halftime report. Geico.com. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
As we continue the countdown to the new year in El Paso, welcome to the Geico Halftime Report. With a score at the Sun Bowl, Oregon leading South Florida 18-14. And now, performing live on the field, hip-hop recording star Baby Bash.
Yee! Yee!
Tell me what it do, tell me what it do.
El Paso, Chuco Town!
What is that?
Welcome back to the 74th annual Sun Bowl here in El Paso.
Welcome back. Just moments away from the start of the third quarter, Oregon leading South Florida 18-14. Let's go downstairs. Here's Sam Ryan.
And Craig, we have Jim Leavitt here, ready to get the second half going. Down by four. What do you need to do to? I know you talk about finishing strong. What do you have to do to get back in this?
Well, you know, Oregon's a good football team. We're about in the position I thought we might be in. You know, we gave Stewart the long run there, and that's the only difference right now. We've got to slow him down. If he hits a number of plays like that, then we'll have problems. But I think we're playing good. Need to protect the football and just, you know, finish these 30 minutes, play well.
Thanks, Jim.
Okay, thank you,
Craig.
Sam, thanks. I don't know if his voice is going to hold out for two more quarters, but we saw a lot of emotion in that first half of play and a lot of penalties as well.
A lot of penalties. A lot of big things happening, good and bad, both ways. He had, for Oregon, the difference maker is the guy that we said had to be the difference maker. That man right there, Jonathan Stewart, running the ball consistently all day long. None bigger than that one. And look at the seam that they've been able to create by their formations and by spreading the field. Tremendous job by Jonathan Stewart cashing in. They've been running the football very well. On the other side, Matt Grothy, he's been doing it with his wheels.
We talked about how Oregon has to contain him and his footwork and his running ability to improvise on the move. They have been able to do it for the most part, but there were a couple times where he got out and made him pay big time.
And we look at the first half stats brought to you by Brute and the rushing yards. Of course, Oregon with 205 yards, 142 of those coming off the feet of Stewart.
Jonathan Stewart's been the key without a doubt. 279 yards total. He's got probably close to 200 of their yards rushing. On the other side of the coin, you look at South Florida, only 26 yards running the football. About 22 of them came on the big run by Matt Grothy. So South Florida has got to find a way to get their running game going to try and alleviate some of the pressure on Matt Grothy's shoulders and try and open up some things down the field. Now, Nick Aliotti, the coach for Oregon, the defensive coordinator, he told us that he was going to pack people in there until they were convinced that they had to get out of doing that and had to cover more of the football field from a passing game.
Now, in that first half, we saw 18 penalties thrown. That ties the Sun Bowl record. I mean, we're talking four quarters, but we got it done in two. Well, do you see the emotion of this game continuing, or do both these teams settle down and get back to what they do best?
Well, you heard Mike Bellotti at halftime going in saying, we have got to regain our composure and our poise. They're one of the least penalized teams in the country. I think Jim Leavitt understands you don't get to be a top football team with that kind of decision-making on the field. The penalties, they will come back and haunt you all the time. I expect to get control of that the second half by both teams.
Third quarter underway, and the Bulls will start at their own 20-yard line after Taurus Johnson puts down a knee at the in 5 yards deep into the end zone, and there's some talking going on. We expect that. This may be a great rivalry they can build on. The Pac-10, the Big East, Oregon, South Florida.
I think they can. You never know. I can tell you right now, there are emotions flying, and I think it's because both teams understand, the players and the coaches understand, how vitally important it is to end your season on a positive note.
Well, you never play one another unless you match up in a bowl game. Of course, the two conferences, one on the West Coast, the other on the East. So Grothy will start this drive at the 20-yard line. Quick throw, near sideline, little pitch and catch. Amari Jackson leans out. A good gain on first down. Jairus Byrd the tackle. And anytime you can pick up beyond 4 yards on first down, you have succeeded. You look at what the South Florida Bulls did in that first half. Grothy, 13 of 25, 168 yards. Mitchell with 4-2 speed. Did not catch a football.
Now, they've had two chances to hit him up the field for big plays. Matt Grothy has not made those throws. They've got to make a couple big plays in the passing game, and Mitchell's the one to do it.
Grothy will tuck and run the football first down. And that's what he does well. He will do that little pump, put the ball back down, wiggle, and wait for a blocker, and he'll squeeze off three or four or five yards.
And that stuff that you're talking about, Craig, is all by design. It's all about allowing the blocks to take place before him, in front of him. He's very patient running the football. He will not go and hit the hole until the hole is there, until the timing is right. And that's something that is very, very hard to learn how to do as a running quarterback.
Rothy now 10 carries for 33 yards from the shotgun. Good protection. Rifles it up and over the middle. Oh, big hit. Johnson took a hit. Bird delivered it big, and Johnson lost the football.
Wow, that's just a tremendous play by Jarris Bird, son of former NFL quarterback Gilbert. He times this thing perfectly. I think Torres Johnson felt like he was wide open, didn't have anything to worry about, but Jarris Bird, absolute perfect timing, and went in there and dislodged that ball from Torres Johnson.
Johnson with a couple of catches. Like to have that one back. That brings up second down and 10. The Ducks show blitz. They pull back. Rothe throws it out to the flat. It's caught as Benjamin Williams slides to the 35-yard line. Walter Thurman III, the right corner there, to make the tackle. Good look at Benjamin Williams, the junior from Lake Wales, Florida. Only 5'7", 200-pounder. He's that kind of that scat back, but you pack in 200 on a 5'7 frame, you know he's a strong runner.
Yeah, he's got that Maurice Jones-Drew look to
yes.
him, you know. Nice, compact to the ground, very quick, but he's low to the ground. You got to wrap up on him to get him down.
Rothe, third down and 8. Out of the pocket, throws it off his back foot, up top, incomplete. Bogan, the intended receiver, and that time, Oregon flush, Drothy out of the pocket and force that pass up incomplete.
Well, you know what was very evident to me the whole first half and into the second half now as well after the first series, that Oregon really is playing discipline. When Matt Drothy leaves the pocket, the defenders who have pass responsibility are so well versed on the fact that they cannot drop their coverage. Because a lot of times you're going to see guys wide open, with the exception of the touchdown in the first half to Taurus Johnson. There hasn't been anybody open up the field.
Alvarado back to punt for the fourth time. Great hang time. And a fair catch at the 13. That's the 17-yard line. And a fair catch, 13:02 to play. 47-yard punt. We'll be back to the Sun Bowl after this. We want to thank MetLife for providing today's bird-eye view of all the football action down below. MetLife provides aerial coverage at about 70 televised events a year. And Steve Berline, who was the last defensive lineman to be named MVP of the Sun Bowl? That's today's Aflac trivia question. Think about it. We'll have the answer a little bit later on.
I got a couple of ideas.
Oregon with the football and the lead. Early minutes here of the third quarter. Handoff and the quick cut back. Stewart driving, stacked up at the 20-yard line.
Well, Craig, we heard from Jim Leavitt there coming out to start this second half. He understands, as any good football coach would, that if they don't find a way to shut down the running attack of Oregon and what Jonathan Stewart was able to do to them in the first half, they don't have a chance. Coaches always say you got to be able to run the ball, you got to be able to stop the run. Well, there's a reason why they all say it. If they don't shut it down, they're going to pay the price all day.
Well, Stewart over 10 yards of carry, thanks to that 71-yard touchdown in the first half. Roper goes up top and triple coverage and overthrew Jason Williams. Trey Williams was back on coverage. Now you look at the Ducks uniforms. Have you noticed throughout the season they have worn a different uniform combination every ball game? How about this? Jersey and pants, they come in black, green, white, or yellow. And you have a pick of helmets, green, white, or yellow. Different combination every time they hit the football field.
That, to me, that's just a little bit too much thought going into all that stuff.
You're not a fashion guy, are you?
No, just give me the pads and the ball. I'm ready to roll.
Roper throws. Nice pass. On a rope to the far sideline, Williams makes the grab around Mike Jenkins.
Oh, you're right. That was Roper with a rope right there. That ball was a frozen rope on time, on the money, against good coverage. You're dealing with a guy out there that is a pretty darn good cornerback in Mike Jenkins. In fact, as I said, Mel Kiper rates him the number one pro prospect at the corner position.
Oregon going a little hurry-up offense. Stewart runs by Roper, takes that handoff, and South Florida not fooled. They drop Stewart at the 30-yard line. Richard Kleebert with the tackle, the nose tackle.
Well, I really believe this second half is going to come down to whether or not Justin Roper can make some plays in the passing game. Because Jim Leavitt, his staff, they had to, as we pointed out a minute ago, they had to hammer it into this defense. We will not let them beat us with running the football. We can't. Make this freshman quarterback, redshirt freshman quarterback, make some plays in the passing game.
He has kept his cool thus far, making his first collegiate start here at the Sun Bowl in El Paso. Especially when you have Jonathan Stewart, you kind of have that calming feeling, don't you? The consensus All-American.
Yeah, it's a nice resource to have that in the backfield right next to you. But you can see right now, you come out here in this first drive, the yards are not coming nearly as easily for the Oregon running game at this point. They're looking at 3rd and 9 right now, and that is the key. If you can shut them down on 1st and 2nd down, keep them in a 3rd and long situation, you've got the advantage as a defense.
And that's the talented quarterback, Dennis Dixon, the Pac-10 Player of the Year, injured back in mid-November. Calling plays for Roper on the sideline, and the big fella out, stumbling at the 40, and reaches to the 45-yard line. Ben Moffitt made the tackle. Roper showing he's got some legs.
Well, Mike Bellotti told us, hey, he's not Dennis Dixon, but this kid is a pretty darn good athlete. He can run the ball. He's not going to try and run over anybody or fool anybody, but look, he knew where he had to get for that first down. He made a few guys miss and made the extra yards. He's got that tall, linky, lanky body, those legs kind of flying around everywhere. It's hard to get a hold of him.
Oh, the quick hitter, Jonathan Stewart, rumbling to the 20 and pushed out of bounds at the 10-yard line. That was an explosion by Jonathan Stewart.
Well, watch again the seam. Now, for the most part, the first few plays this half, there was not that seam, but right there, Jonathan Stewart is too good to give him any kind of a seam like that. If he sees that green grass and that smooth sailing out in front of him, he's going to make the play every single time.
41 yards, 186 on the afternoon, and 9 100-yard rushing games this season. Nate Allen shaking up on that play at midfield for South Florida. Well, Jonathan Stewart right now running away with MVP honors here at the Sun Bowl. The 71-yard touchdown in the first half, and just ran 41 yards to the 14.
Well, he's making it look pretty easy right now. It's just not supposed to be that easy, but you got to give credit to the Oregon staff, the offensive staff, for making the adjustments that they've made to their running game. Something obviously is catching South Florida off guard.
Well, he's had limited practice time because of turf toe and looks fresh and strong today. 8th play of this drive. 1st and 10 at the South Florida 13-yard line. Roper, shotgun, pumps near side, drops it up over the middle, and complete. Oh, he had a man open. Jason Williams had split the defense on that post pattern.
He was wide open, and Roper did a great job setting back. He pumps to the right side and creates. Watch him take the pump fake, pumps it to the left side, draws the safety and the coverage just the way he wanted to, and Jason Williams is not going to get, he knows that you just don't get that open. It doesn't happen that way. When you get those chances, you got to hit them. Redshirt freshman got a little bit excited there.
2nd down and 10. Roper rolls out, slingshots, a touchdown, Williams! And Dennis Dixon, oh, he likes what that young man just did.
Well, not only did Justin Roper make up for missing a touchdown, he got the touchdown back, and he got it to the right guy again. Gave Jason Williams another chance to make a play. And he makes the play, has a great opportunity to make the throw, and Jason Williams cashes it in for pay dirt.
Well, the Ducks will go for two, or now one. They had it lined up for the two, and they kick it up and through. 25-14, Roper. You give him a second chance, and he makes you pay as Williams scores his 8th touchdown of the season. 25-14, Oregon.
C
CBS Sports presentation of the Brute Sun Bowl is sponsored by Sonic. It's not just good, it's Sonic good. The first ever G8 from Pontiac, the official performance machine of the NCAA. And by Ruby Tuesday, simple, fresh, American dining. Welcome back. Sun Bowl in El Paso, Texas. 9 plays, 82 yards, 2:45 off the clock. And Williams on that 14-yard touchdown reception, his eighth touchdown of the season. And that puts Oregon on top 25-14.
Well, the Ducks did exactly what they wanted to do, coming out and establishing the second half tempo. They popped the big run with Jonathan Stewart right there and then cashed it in off a play action with a couple of big plays from Justin Roper.
Murphy and Johnson back to receive the kick, and there will be no return. Well, Steve, I asked you earlier the Aflac trivia question, and who was the last defensive lineman to be named MVP of the Sun Bowl? Well, the answer, Cornelius Bennett, Alabama, 1986.
That was my guess. I know that man.
Yes, you do.
I know that man. Came out of Notre Dame the same year he came out of Alabama, 1986. And what a tremendous athlete, tremendous NFL career he had. One of the all-time greats.
Oregon with a 25-14 lead. We'll see what Matt Grothy and South Florida can do. They have big play capability. They go play action to the flat. It's caught. Johnson and rolls to the 28-yard line. Now let's talk about Cornelius Bennett. Three-time All-American with the Tide, 1986 SEC Player of the Year. He knows the Super Bowl well, Buffalo and Atlanta.
Never got the ring for the Super Bowl, but to be there four times is a testament to how great he was. Just never quite was able to be on a team that finished off the deal.
Second down and one, shotgun Grothy. Out of the pocket, can run, watch out, 30. And then trots out of bounds at the 34-yard line. Now, how about October 4th, 1986? Do you remember this? The sack, Mr. Berline. Notre Dame, Bama. And Steve Berline takes a licking. Cornelius Bennett, 28-10 the final. And I know you told me you don't remember much. And this painting adorns the Alabama Hall of Fame. Yes, a Notre Dame quarterback in the Crimson Tide Hall of Fame. Congratulations.
The best thing about that play is that I don't remember much about it.
Little trickery. Around comes Johnson. Ball's loose. Oregon recovers at the 37. Nick Reed comes up with a loose football.
Well, Taurus Johnson knows better. Look at how he's carrying that football. Coming around the corner right there. One hand on the ball. That is not going to get you any points in the positive fashion from your coach. It's not a good example to set for your teammates. You tuck that ball away.
And there is a flag.
After the fumble recovery, unsportsmanlike conduct, number 49 of the defense spiking the ball. It'll be Oregon's ball following a 15-yard penalty.
Well, Taurus Johnson, he's a tremendous athlete, and the coach has told us how important he is to this offense, but that ball needs to be tucked away. I don't care how clear you think you've got it. Unless your initials are T.O., and you can palm the ball like he can, that ball needs to be tucked away, and Taurus Johnson knows that.
Hey now. Injured player is Patrick Chung, one of the team captains on the defensive side, and he's getting some help off. Well, Steve, we just saw the record penalty for the Sun Bowl.
Not one either coach would be proud of, no.
19 now combined today, and that is a Sun Bowl fact. And just into the third quarter, 5 minutes and change, 25-14 Oregon with the lead, and now the football after the fumble. Roper slings it out to the flat. It's caught. Dixon
And good pursuit. Ben Moffitt covered a lot of turf in a short period of time. I'd say he is a model linebacker, 6'2", about 245, and could go sideline to sideline.
And that's the reason why he's projected to be a pretty high draft choice come this next April. I keep waiting for Oregon. They keep throwing that ball backwards. I'm thinking they're setting up some kind of a double pass that might be showing itself here at some point.
In motion, Flugrad. Now drops back behind Roper. Roper slings it hard to the 40-yard line, and another reception by the Ducks. Garen Strong, who had a touchdown in the first half with the grab. And the Ducks continue to push the chains.
That was a super nice throw by Justin Roper. He didn't even realize it, but he barely got that ball off. Big Alan Cray, number 94, was breathing down his neck and made him pay the price. But Justin Roper popped right back up and said it's worth taking a shot for a big gain in the pass game.
Strong now with three receptions, 36 yards. As Roper goes shotgun, flies out of the pocket, drops it up top and out of bounds. Strong was in the area, but it's hard to get by that corner, the cover corner, Trey Williams.
It is. Strong is one of those guys that he will always have his presence felt at some point. This South Florida defense knows that number 21 is the object of a lot of creativity from this Oregon coaching staff. They try to find ways to get him the ball. That was a good job on defense there.
Now a timeout. Play clock running out, and Roper and the Ducks call timeout. Oregon and South Florida here at the Sun Bowl, second down and 10, and the Ducks with a 25-14 lead, led by the redshirt freshman Justin Roper. Sets up the screen. Watch out, watch out. Jonathan Stewart out of bounds at the 20-yard line. Mike Jenkins gave him a hit. Boy, Jonathan Stewart, we talked about the turf toe, limited practice, stretching out that shoe to give that toe some room. But Steve, he is fresh. I see no signs of any pain. He's cutting, running strong.
Well, what I want to see is, well, I want to know why Oregon on this play. Watch how they set this screen up. It's set up perfectly well. And watch when Jonathan Stewart catches up. But look at this. No one in front of him. He had nothing but green grass for 20, 25 yards.
Incomplete on the one hopper. Andre Crenshaw wide open. That ball took a short bounce off the hand of Roper. Second down and 10. Steve, I'm amazed at the poise of Roper in this ball game.
Well, he looks very much under control. He's not rattled a bit, taking a few shots and still standing strong in there.
From the shotgun, the handoff, a quick pop up the middle. And Crenshaw is dropped. 16-yard line. Well, some injuries starting to pile up a little bit. Understand Jeff Mayo, the wideout, is out for Oregon with a concussion. And South Florida has lost their wideout. Carlton Mitchell re-aggravated the groin and also bruised a tailbone. So the physical play beginning to take its toll. Roper. Touchdown, Oregon. Dixon, wide open.
Well, not to be confused with Dennis Dixon. This is Ed Dixon, the big tight end. Very nice job of selling the play action or the roll to the right. Get everything moving right side and drag Ed Dixon, number 83, across the field, where he's one-on-one on the backside with Trey Williams. That's a matchup that Oregon loves.
Third touchdown catch of the season for Ed Dixon. The extra point is through the uprights. It's been all Oregon here in the third quarter, led by the redshirt freshman. Easy, smooth stroke and wide open for six. We'll come back. El Paso, Texas on CBS. Well, there's the two that combine for that touchdown. On your left, Roper. On your right, Dixon. Seven plays, 51 yards. And on that drive, Justin Roper, 3 of 5, 48 yards, and the 15-yard throw to Dixon.
Really, really impressed with how Oregon has come out this second half. Two drives, two touchdowns. Roper, 5 of 8 on those two drives with two touchdown passes.
Well, the kick, Evenson. Steady all day long. And Sunday, the NFL on CBS rocks with the AFC wildcard game between the Titans and the Chargers. And don't forget, the excitement begins with JB, Dan, Coach, Shannon, and Boomer on a special edition of the NFL Today. More people watch NFL games on CBS than any other network. LT will be in action as we start the playoffs.
That'll be a physical. In the playoffs, they're all physical, but that is two physical football teams. Be a fun game to watch.
All of a sudden, an Oregon explosion, and the Ducks lead 32-14. Matt Grothy, three wideouts, near side. Grothy stands in that pocket, throws in traffic. It's picked off. Forget it. Touchdown, Thurman. You mentioned you play with fire, and he has all afternoon.
No doubt about it. That could have happened much earlier in this game. He's made some really good throws, made some tremendous plays, but he's thrown several passes that really had you saying, oh boy, he can't get away with that right there. Fell right into the trap set by Thurman, hit him right in the chest, and boy, turnovers have really hurt South Florida this year, and their losses today, no exception. The fumble by Torres Johnson, and then that interception this half.
Evenson punches through the extra point. Thurman with his fifth interception of the season runs it back 25 yards.
Well, what happened right here with Matt Grothy? He thought he had a nice clean throw, but Walter Thurman steps in from the outside. Matt Grothy didn't even see him, and it was exactly like you draw it up if you're an Oregon Duck. And we'll see what happens. Grothy also finishes it up to make it worse. Takes a little double whammy there. And that's just kind of to sit down and to lay down and have to watch that ball go into the end zone as a quarterback is about as bad as it gets.
13th interception thrown on the season by Grothy. And all of a sudden, Oregon, 21-point third quarter and 7:25 to play. Another fine kick, and the Bulls will not bring it out. Torres Johnson takes a knee, and so South Florida will try to shake this off. And Grothy comes out emotional. ...39-14. If you joined us, a battle in the first half. Emotional, physical, a lot of penalties. 18-14 at the break in favor of the Ducks, and now Oregon with three touchdowns here in less than, halfway through the third.
Well, the key right now for South Florida is to understand you still got a quarter and a half left. And we've seen how quickly Oregon has been able to score 21. If South Florida can get a drive right here, move down the field and score a touchdown, they've been not able to get it in when they've been in the red zone, two field goals. If they get down there, they've got to cash in and score, they can get themselves back in this game.
This drive will start at the 20, first and 10. Pressure, Grothy in trouble. Spins out, oh, he's still on his feet. Pumps, still on his feet, dropped at the 10 and a fumble. I believe Grothy was able to reach out and recover, but Oregon all over Matt Grothy.
Well, I can't believe he got out of the first pressure that he gets right here. He's got two guys that have a good shot at him, and then Kevin Garrett comes over and finishes off the deal. And almost another tragedy for South Florida in that Matt Grothy almost fumbled that football, almost lost that football.
A loss of 8, second down and 18, 3 sacks. He's been hurried 9 times and knocked down once. Defensive pressure really picked up here in the third quarter for Oregon. Ducks done up front. Grothy throws over the middle. And that ball is brought down by A.J. Love, a redshirt freshman.
Matt Grothy still again, a young quarterback, only a sophomore. Hard to be in those shoes right now where you understand that you don't have to do it all at once. And you don't have to do it all by yourself. Just make good decisions, worry about this drive, and let the rest of it take care of itself.
Well, he'll find himself in that preseason Heisman talk in 08. Third down and eight. Shotgun, Grothy. Bulls need a first down. Stands, now runs out of the pocket. Got a big man in front. Sets those feet, throws up top. Picked off at the 40. Bird will run it to midfield in Oregon. Back-to-back interceptions.
That's just another one of those situations where he's trying, Grothy's trying to give his player, his teammate, Bogan, out there a chance to make a play up the field, but I just don't know. He's not open up the field. You're thinking, well, give him a chance to make a play. I just think it's a little bit too early to get desperate and try and make a play that's not there. I like the attitude. I like him going for it. I just don't think the time is right. I think that was kind of out of desperation more than anything.
Bird with his second or sixth interception of the season. Roper runs out of trouble, dumps it off, incomplete. And a flag is down. Now, Tyrone McKenzie was bringing pressure on Roper, and we'll get the call.
Fitch Bask, 5-yard penalty, number 27, penalized from the previous spot. Repeat first down.
Well, obviously, turnovers will affect an outcome. Today, two interceptions. You look at what happened at Rutgers, a pick. At UConn, a couple. At Cincinnati, four interceptions and three fumbles in those three losses.
Yeah, 11 turnovers in the three losses. It's a marked difference from what it is when they win the ball games. And there's no mystery to that. You turn the ball over, you're going to lose. Today, those two interceptions and the fumble by Taurus Jackson, they've really hurt the team.
Stewart, the handoff. And rumbles to the 41-yard line. Stewart is flirting with 200 yards on the ground, Steve. 191, 17 carries.
Well, he's going to get a few more carries this game. There's still a quarter and a half left almost. And with Oregon completely in control, I think they're going to probably feature number 28 pretty significantly here.
Up the middle, big hole. Driving forward again is Stewart. Once you run downhill, it is so difficult to drop him.
It really is. Again, we said 235 pounds, but it's amazing to me that it's still as easy as it is for the Oregon defense. I think that the Jim Leavitt and his staff, I really expected him to come out and really try and shut down this running game and be more effective in doing so.
Over 200 yards now for Stewart. Roper throws, caught, 10, 5, out of bounds. Flugrad at the 1-yard line.
Love the play call right there. The play action away after a good run the play before. And your motion man, Aaron Flugrad, the true freshman, whose dad is the wide receivers coach, and Dennis Dixon loves it too. Oregon's got it rolling on all cylinders right now. Nice play call, good creativity, and wonderful execution by the Oregon Ducks.
Fumbled out of bounds, so they'll mark it at the one. First and goal. Oh, what an offensive output here by Oregon. And the fumble on the snap. Roper covers up. A couple of times Roper's had trouble bringing that ball in.
Well, this is one, it's just repetition. He's trying to catch the ball and make the quick handoff to Jonathan Stewart. It was a designed run, motion Stewart into the backfield and then run him off the left side. He tried to hand it off before he secured the ball. Just a mistake that'll happen. I don't care whether you're a redshirt freshman or a veteran senior quarterback. Every once in a while you get a little too excited to try and make that handoff before you get the ball.
That brings up second down and goal from the 7-yard line. Roper, play action, rolls near side, throws incomplete. Derek Jones, that ball was thrown so hard, I thought it knocked him over.
He was wide open, too. The ball is thrown. You're going to see it's behind Jones. He cannot make the turn to make that catch, but wide open. And that you know, that's just one of those things. The Roper's made a lot of really good throws today. That was not one of his better ones. You'd like to have that one back because it's an easy touchdown.
Roper now 15 of 26, 171 yards, and three touchdowns along the way.
That should have been four.
On third and goal, with a slip pass up the middle, walking in, touchdown, Stewart!
So there's number four.
Penalty flag on the field.
There is a penalty flag. And the touchdown stands. Stewart puts Oregon on top 45 to 14. And Evenson trots out for the extra point.
This has been an absolute clinic in the second, this third quarter by Mike Bellotti and his Oregon Ducks. That's 21 points off of the three turnovers. Two interceptions and a fumble by Matt Grothy and Taurus Johnson. That's led to 21 unanswered points in the second half.
Six plays, 51 yards, and a minute 40 off the clock. Back-to-back interceptions thrown by South Florida. And you have to tip your hat to Justin Roper. First collegiate start, Sun Bowl. There's one, and there's two. Four touchdowns on the afternoon for Justin Roper.
And you got to give the kid credit. He's played very, very calm and cool and collected, made good decisions all day long. Also, need to give a lot of credit to Chip Kelly, Mike Bellotti, and that staff, though, for creating really, really good opportunities to make those throws and make those plays. There's a reason why these guys are open.
Dennis Dixon, you saw there, greeting Roper. And as you mentioned, the 21 points scored off the turnovers. You know, you look at the Sun Bowl record book, and another record has been set. Oregon scoring 28 points in the third quarter. That surpasses, in 1984, Maryland and Tennessee put 22 up. That's 28 for Oregon here in the third. And still over four minutes to play. If you are a South Florida fan, a stunning third quarter.
To say the least, a very stunning third quarter. I really expected to see this team come out and make the adjustments and make the ball game more their style. To really fly around on defense, make some plays, create problems for Oregon. That has not happened all day.
Grothy out of the pocket, swings it near side, out of bounds. Marcus Edwards out of Mayo, Florida, was the intended receiver. Well, Steve, compare the two today. Grothy, the sophomore, young, great career still ahead. Roper, the redshirt freshman. 198 yards passing for Grothy, 179 for Roper. But you look at that last stat, one touchdown, two interceptions for Grothy, four touchdowns, no mistakes for Roper. Grothy runs out of the pocket, dropped at the 26-yard line.
And it's not going to get any easier for Matt Grothy right now. He's now in a position down, I don't even know if I can count that high, but he's down a lot. And he's down enough to where he's going to have to start making pass plays in this ball game. He's going to have to start forcing the issue, trying to make some scores quickly. Being down 32 points, the clock now becomes a factor for sure.
Under 3.5 to play in the third quarter. Grothy throws complete. Cedric Hill. And again, Walter Thurman, they're bringing it. There's no let up by Oregon.
Well, the corners for Oregon have played spectacular football today. Walter Thurman and Jairus Byrd, that was a fantastic read by Walter Thurman coming up and reading that quick pass out there. forcing South Florida to do what they do not want to do anymore, and that's punt the football.
Jarris Bird is set to receive the punt. Line drive, Bird, 36, falls forward to the 38-yard line. And the new year is just about here. I'm sure El Paso will be a fun spot tonight.
I think it will.
Right now, at least for Oregon fans.
You're going to have a lot of happy people wearing green, and unfortunately, there's going to be a lot of unhappy people wearing South Florida green, but I think everybody will agree. The people of El Paso have made this very enjoyable for everyone.
Yeah, terrific time. Roper the handoff.
Andre!
Crenshaw.
Andre, get up the field.
Maybe one up to the 39.
Andre Crenshaw, number
and the 22. Clock running up to 2 minutes left in the third quarter. Well, the numbers beginning to really pile up. Roper, nearly 180 yards passing, over 200 yards rushing for Jonathan Stewart. Those two have combined for 5 touchdowns.
Just really solid football. There's not been one time during this game where you felt like Oregon did not know exactly what was going on.
Stewart back in, carries a pile of Bulls past the 45. He is so tough after the initial hit.
He really is. I mean, and to do what he's doing, I cannot emphasize enough how painful and how much that turf toe injury has affected him, and to come out and carry this rock the way that he's carried it today, and to answer the bell, to take some of the pressure off the redshirt freshman Justin Roper, absolutely spectacular.
One more time.
Wow.
Well, he ran through a wall, and that wall was Gillum.
Yeah. And that wall came tumbling down.
Yes, it did, brick by brick. My goodness, what a collision.
There's no doubt who won that collision.
Well, no more history today. Stewart, first player in Sun Bowl history to rush for over 200 yards. Tough Tony Dorsett, Thurman Thomas, they've run on this field. But Stewart getting it done. You know, he had a 251-yard game against Washington this season. If he stays on the field in the fourth quarter, he has the potential to surpass that.
He can do it. There's no doubt about it. He can do it. And he told us he was ready, didn't he?
Yes, he did. We asked him, what percentage are you? I don't talk percentages. I just play. I just play.
Good answer.
Got an injured South Florida player down. And Saturday, we've got 3 scoops of hoop as Penn State takes on Michigan State, and Tennessee battles Notre Dame in women's basketball. And in the nightcap, Rick Pitino's Louisville Cardinals take on their cross-state rival, Kentucky. And it's right here on the home of the NCAA Men's Basketball Championship, CBS Sports. A tough road for Kentucky so far this season. High hopes. New head coach, Tubby, has moved on to Minnesota. And now Billy Gillespie under the direction at Kentucky. There's another flag drop as Ben Moffitt put pressure and holding the call.
Yeah, they're going to get Ed Dixon, number 83, as that pocket kind of broke down. Nobody was open. He was trying to help his quarterback out, but resorted to a little bit of a jersey tug, shall we say.
Holding, number 83. Penalty is declined. Be third down.
But now understand, I'm a big fan of doing whatever you got to do to keep the guy off the quarterback. I told all my offensive line, you got to hold him to keep him from hitting me. Go ahead and do it. That's fine.
You want to be there for one more play at least.
Right. You can't fumble if they get a holding call and you don't get hit.
Third down, 11. Draw. Crenshaw. 30 seconds left on the third quarter clock. You like this combination, Stewart and Crenshaw. You know, Stewart does the bulk of the work, but when you get Andre Crenshaw coming in as your second back, that's a luxury.
Well, he can hurt you in a hurry. He's shown already today. He's only touched the ball maybe 7 or 8 times, but he can make up quick yards in a hurry.
So the Ducks forced to punt as the clock runs down to 7.
You got to let it run out.
Oh, what a third quarter for Oregon. That ends the third with the score. 46-14, Oregon. Oregon took this game over in the third quarter. 4 touchdowns. 2 scored off 2 turnovers by South Florida. Good snap. And with the wind behind him, Syree boots that ball out of the end zone. So
that wasn't even close.
No. If he was trying to pooch it, he a little bit lost. Strong leg. We'll be back.
And now it's time for our Geico scoring recap.
Well, we start in the first quarter. Justin Roper, the redshirt freshman, rolling out, finds Garen Strong. And then Delbert Alvarado, a field goal of 29 yards for USF. Oregon comes back. Matt Evenson from 39 yards. Well, the Bulls find the end zone. Taurus Johnson from Grothy. That tied the game up at 11. Jonathan Stewart then rumbles 71 yards to put Oregon on top, 18-11. And then the field goal off of Alvarado's foot from 35. And we're tied, or the game's 18-14 at the half. Third quarter, this game really broke open. Roper to Jason Williams. And then Ed Dixon finds the end zone from 15 yards out. And then Grothy makes the mistake. Thurman, the interception, runs it back, 39-14. And then Stewart caps off the quarter with another touchdown. And that's where we stand, 46-14, with 14:51 to play. Grothy will tuck and run. Oh, a couple of helmets. Oh, and one's off. Grothy took a shot high and low. Steve, you have to give credit to Oregon. They have not let up. They have punished, continued to punish South Florida.
That was a shot right there. I was a little bit dazed. I saw Matt Grohl. He's hurt. That was a shot.
No, Grothy got up. And, you know, we saw him momentarily, and the eyes looked to be a little glazed. And then he just went down.
He tried to get up. His instinct tells him to get up. And we said he doesn't get hit very hard very often because of his running style. But you'll watch this one. I think it was Matthew Harper, number 20, coming in right there. And you can't really see it from that angle, but that's who it was. It was number 30. That was Kwame Ajiman. And he got up and then said, wait a minute, something is not right. I'm going to sit down and think about this for a second.
CBS Sports presentation of the Brute Sun Bowl is sponsored by Brute Revolution, as different as you are. Geico, 15 minutes could save you 15% on car insurance. And by the new AT&T, your world delivered. Welcome back, El Paso, Texas. Good news, Matt Grothy is up after taking a wicked shot on that last play. He'll go to the sideline, second down and 6, and Grant Gregory, the junior from Athens, Ohio, checks in. Took a few warm-up passes on the sideline while Grothy was down and throws complete to Jesse Hester. And Steve, moments ago.
Yeah, this is a shot that he takes a direct hit to the helmet and the shoulder right there. It was a very violent hit. And I tell you, Matt Grothy, to his credit, he is a tough guy. He tried to get up and get back to the huddle, but it just wasn't right. First and foremost, we're obviously always concerned with the well-being of the players, so they're not going to let him come back in this game unless they're absolutely sure he's fine.
Well, even more difficult to bring him back in a 46-14 ball game. Ball is tipped and intercepted. Jairus Byrd.
Well, when it rains, it pours. Grant Gregory standing strong in the pocket, trying to make a throw, make a play. It gets tipped up in the air. And Amari Jackson cannot bring it down. And Jairus Byrd is the one that is the
welcome recipient of that pass, that gift from Grant Gregory.
That ball was tipped three times. Roper remains a quarterback, hands off Stewart, still in the ball game, running near side, and then steps out of bounds. At the 32-yard line, you look at Oregon, Steve Berline, in the second half. You start at your 18-yard line, touchdown. At the 49, you go 51 yards for six more. You start at the 49 again, you go 51 again, and you pick up six. One punt so far in the second half.
Yeah, and that all equals a win, or control of the ball game, as we should say. You know, you're cashing in on your opportunities. When the other team makes a mistake, you make them pay.
And the defense, of course, has come up big as well, scoring a couple of touchdowns in this second half.
Oh.
Stewart. You almost feel like he's toying right now with South Florida's defense.
And you hate to say that because you know it's not true, but the way that he run, I think if there were more question about the outcome of this ball game, you might have seen him lower that shoulder and try and pick up a few extra yards. But he's a guy that he's been through an awful lot this year. He's realizing we're in control of this game. I think I'll just scoot on out of bounds right here.
Well, he went 251 against Washington. 258 yards here at the 74 Sun Bowl. High snap brought down by Roper. It's good to be 6-6. Crenshaw weaving his way. And still, the Bulls are playing very physical, and the officials have to step in. How about the day for Jonathan Stewart?
What kind of day this has been for him. I mean, that one looks pretty easy, and it was, to take it 71 yards for the touchdown, but he's the one that had to carry it there. He went to the right spot, but all day long, he's been making the right choices, making the cuts when he had to, making all the right decisions. It equals to 24 carries, 258 yards, over 10 yards a carry. Plus, he has that screen pass he took in for a touchdown as well. Two scores. Fantastic day for Jonathan Stewart.
Second down, 8. Roper play action. Oh, a little underhand toss, and it goes out of bounds. Alan Cray brought pressure on Roper.
Watch the, I guess more would be laxity of Justin Roper's body here. The way he jumps around and stretches, and that ball's flipping all over the place. He's got those long legs and the long arms. Trying to be Brett Favre there, trying to ad-lib and do whatever he's got to do to make a play.
Well, 6'6", 205. He is really impressed here in El Paso. Drops it off. It's complete to the tight end. Dixon with the grab.
And that's the same play they scored on earlier in the game, the drag route by Ed Dixon. That time, South Florida much better prepared. Ooh, man, someone just went down on the field, too. Walking off the field.
That's Alan Cray. Alan Cray is down, and the staff is out. You look at the total yards today. We'll try a field goal from the 20. This will be a 30-yard kick, and it's up and good. So the Ducks add three more. 49. Third quarter now, carrying into the fourth. Many fans have left the Sun Bowl. 18-14. Steve Berline at the break, and I'd say it's been all Oregon Ducks in the second half.
Yeah, you got to just tip your hat to Oregon and the job they've done coming out this second half and really just taking control of this game.
Evenson the kick. Very few returns, and Murphy will have to take a knee 9 yards deep in the end zone. Well, don't forget, later in the game today, the five-star play of the game presented by Wrangler. I have a feeling Jonathan Stewart will be involved.
He probably will be involved, yes, sir.
You know, as a former quarterback, how do you grade out this young man, Justin Roper, today?
I give him a good, solid A right there. I mean, I think he's done a super job.
of managing this football team and doing exactly what Mike Bellotti has asked him to do, and that is not make the bonehead plays, the mistake plays, you know, where you really sit there and that'll cost your team. He's made no plays like that all day long.
Mike Ford, the ball carrier, as Grothy remains on the bench. Grant Gregory will most likely take South Florida the rest of the way. There's a look at Gregory out of Athens, Ohio. Well, South Florida with 9 wins this year, that tied the school record. And see, they were hoping for 10, which would set a new school record in Tampa.
It was really important to this ball club to do it. Everybody, to a man, they were all saying the same thing. And really, I felt they were going to be prepared for this ball game.
Under 12 minutes to play. Ball batted down. Line of scrimmage incomplete.
You know, and Jim Leavitt told us that he really felt that his team had earned the right. We talked about the Big Four earlier, the Big Four from Florida. If it's legitimate, I do definitely think it is legitimate. They had wins, as we said earlier this year, over 3 conference champions. Big East, they beat West Virginia. From Conference USA, they came out and they played and they beat Central Florida. And then from the Sun Belt Conference, they beat Florida Atlantic. No other team has beaten 3 conference champions.
Gregory on the run, takes a pop and slides past the 30 to the 31-yard line to a Tully, the outside linebacker with the hit. Look at the first half compared to the second. Rush yards to the ground game's been non-existent. The passing game fell off, obviously, in that second half. Grothy struggled with interceptions.
Well, this is a team that averages almost 200 yards rushing per game, and today they have 37 yards rushing. Oregon has just come out and slammed the door right from the get-go. You got to give him credit.
Quick throw. A.J. Love on the receiving end. Now, you mentioned the run game. I mean, 193 yards a game. That's second best in the Big East Conference.
Yeah, they are a running football team. They make no bones about it. Now, Matt Grothy, he's the kind of guy that can hurt you and will hurt you in the passing game, but they are a running football team any way you want to slice it. And for Oregon to come out and shut them down. Now, this second half has been totally different. The numbers reflect a different ball game, but they've had so many turnovers and got down so quickly they had to abandon the run.
From the shotgun goes Gregory. Stands in the pocket, flushed on the run. Has room at the 40, 45, 50, and stays in bounds. First down, South Florida at the 45-yard line of Oregon. Boy, Grant Gregory showing some good speed.
Yeah, you know, Grant Gregory, he's the son of offensive coordinator Greg Gregory, who, by the way, has done a fantastic job with this offensive football team all year long. They've been one of the most productive teams. Today, not their best day, but Grant Gregory getting to go out there and have a chance to play for his dad.
Yeah, that father-son combo as we hit the 10-minute mark of the fourth quarter. Gregory pulls that ball back in and is dropped. He'll lose a yard, maybe 2, back to the 46-yard line.
If I'm Grant Gregory, I look over at my dad and I say, Dad, what was that play call all about? Come on, what are you doing? Give me a chance here.
I'm sure there's a lot of football talked in that house.
Oh, huh? I'm sure. Good play by Will Tukuafu. This Oregon team has just had no let-up. They smelled blood early in the third quarter, and they just kept pouring it on, and it's still going on right now.
Gregory on the rollout, throws it up top, and drops incomplete. And there's a flag. Flag on the play. Busy day for Bill Algie and his staff.
Pass interference. Defense penalized 15 yards from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
Well, what percentage of Americans think brunettes are smarter than blondes? The Power of 10 returns with the question that will have America talking Wednesday at 8, 7 Central on CBS. I don't know if we should even touch that question.
No, we're not going to touch that question, but I will say this. It depends on who you ask.
That's true.
Obviously.
Draw play. Jamar Taylor driven back. Well, I tell you, Oregon, I'm impressed again. South Florida continues to try to get the yardage. Oregon, despite the big lead, will not let up.
No, they will not.
They will not let up. They continue to punish or try to punish South Florida.
If you think about it, it makes sense. This is an Oregon team that, after nine games, was in position to make a run at the national championship. And they lose their quarterback, and it's been an absolute miserable month, or 2 months since that happened, losing three straight games and then having to stew over it for a month and going to a game that really doesn't figure into the national championship picture. Very disappointing for them. They've played with a chip on their shoulder all day today.
Gregory throws up top to the end zone. Incomplete. Dontavia Bogan, the intended receiver, has had a couple of nice catches on the afternoon. 8:28 to play. See, that's a great point. If you really take a look at the season, this game is kind of an outpouring of emotion, frustration, and anger.
There's no doubt about it. I mean, this is, you talk to the Oregon players, and as soon as you mention where they were before Dennis Dixon went down, you just see their whole body slump. It's like whenever they're forced to think about it, the memories all come flashing back to them, and they really wanted to try and set the record straight here today that they are a good football team. And in the midst of all this, Mike Bellotti has found himself a pretty good young quarterback in Justin Roper. So the month that they've had to get ready for this game, Mike Bellotti said he could see the progress being made on a daily basis, that with this Justin Roper was really turning into a good, solid young quarterback. And I think he believes now that down the road, they've got more than one quarterback that can play in this program.
Well, Coach Bellotti doesn't expect Roper to put much weight on. He liked to have him around 215, 220.
He just said he didn't have the frame to do it. He is a tall, skinny guy, but boy, he sure has looked good today.
South Florida, 11 of 16 on fourth down tries this season. And a timeout with 8:22 to play.
Timeout. South Florida.
Lead now with 8:22 to play. Fourth and four from the 25-yard line of Oregon. Gregory on the quick throw and a first down. Torres Johnson
pass complete
to the 15-yard line.
Well, Oregon is in a position now, too, where they'll give South Florida all those little short ones over the middle they want to take. Come up and make the tackle. Just keep that ball in the middle of the field. Keep that clock running. They have no problem with that.
South Florida averaging nearly 36 points a game throughout the regular season. Today they've been held to 14, and Oregon crashes down. And again, it's been rough all day trying to run on the Ducks.
Ashton Samuels,
who is like the fourth string running back, gets a carry. Second down and 12 after the 2 yard loss, under 8 minutes to play. We will hear a lot from South Florida as the years continue under Jim Leavitt. In Oregon, Steve Berline is in good hands with Mike Bellotti. Two very good football coaches.
I agree 100%. Jim Leavitt, his team will be back. They've learned a lot throughout the course of this season about what it takes to be a top-flight team. And the pressure that if you want to produce and if you want to be recognized as one of the best teams in the country, there's a price to pay. And you've got to show up every single week. And I think the lessons learned even from a game like this today will carry over, and he'll try and find a positive spin on it.
You know, you mentioned some of the big wins against those conference champs, but don't forget, South Florida also beat Auburn. Tommy Tuberville.
They're darn right.
SEC country, right?
They sure did. They are legitimate. There is no doubt about it. Today just wasn't their day.
Gregory out of the pocket. Looks at the end zone. Pulls it back. Throws again. Touchdown. A.J. Love. So through all the struggles here in the second half and the injury to Grothy, Grant Gregory off the bench and throws a touchdown to A.J. Love.
This is the kind of thing you look for, too, if you are a head coach like Jim Leavitt. You look and see how your guys compete. Even when you're down and even when it looks like this game may be out of reach,
Did these guys hang it up and throw in the towel, or do they keep competing? And Grant Gregory has not let his offense take it off. They've gone out there and competed, and they've found a way to get in the end zone.
First touchdown in the career of A.J. Love. Alvarado kicks it up and good. And let's go downstairs and check in with Sam.
And Craig, it's Dennis Dixon here. Keep him busy on the sideline. You're trying to signal in the plays here and being a mentor. How important is it for you to just stay involved in the game?
It's good. I mean, I had this brought upon me when I was growing up too. Kellen Clemens guided me through the process, and I just figured I'd just return the favor.
Now, Justin Roper didn't seem nervous going into this game. What did you tell him before this one?
Tell him just to have fun. I mean, stay calm, cool, and collected. I mean, just go and practice. It's nothing. It's nothing but practice. People filled up the stadium. That's all.
What is he doing right this afternoon?
I beg your pardon?
What is he doing correct this afternoon?
Not turning the ball over, which is good, which is giving us a shot to make plays.
Now, you actually partially tore the ligament in your knee in the Arizona State game, then played in the Arizona game before you actually went down. You made that decision. If you had to do it all over again, would you still make that decision?
I'd make it again. I don't regret anything. I mean, at that point, I felt as if my knee was stable. I feel confident on the first score touchdown, running touchdown. I mean, it's just one freak accident, that's all.
Dennis, thank you. Good luck in the future.
Thank you.
Craig?
All right, Sam, thank you. Dennis Dixon. Yeah, a lot of people forget, injured at during the Arizona State game, and that knee buckled again and gave way against Arizona November 15th, taking one of the top premier quarterbacks out of the game. Big return by Jones up to around the 45-yard line. And you look at, Tebow, of course, a Heisman Trophy winner. 10 games for Dixon, 12 for Tebow. I mean, Steve, and many coaches that we talked to and players would say, had Dixon stayed healthy, in their minds, it could have changed the outcome of the Heisman vote.
Looking back at it, there's really no way to tell. But you have to understand, too, this number right here, 10 games, really was just 9 games and a quarter of that 10th game. So he would have had 3 more full games. I think, in my opinion, Oregon would be one of the teams right up there with a chance to play for the national championship. And I guarantee you that the voting for the Heisman Trophy would have been a lot more interesting. I think Dennis Dixon would have been right in the middle of it without a doubt.
Number 5.
Well, that's the thing about the game. As you know, injury plays such a big part. How deep you are will take you how far some teams progress as the season continues on. And plus, too, don't forget, West Virginia lost late to Pittsburgh, and that changed the whole outcome of the BCS title game as well.
It sure did. I mean, the way the system is set up right now, you can't lose a game late in the year or you don't have a chance. But point being about Dennis Dixon, when he was playing, when he was healthy, this Oregon ball club was as good as anybody in the country, and they're sure playing pretty well today, too.
Well, Cody Kemp has now checked in for Justin Roper in relief. That's Alston, the ball carrier, dropped down. The clock now running down to 5.5 to play.
One last point, though, on Dennis Dixon, just to talk about. This is a kid that the more I learn about him, the more I read about him, the more I understand that there's a lot more to him than what you see on the field. He's a happy kid. He's a 3.4 student, academic All-American. He's got his priorities right, and he's going to come out of this okay. He's young enough to wear this injury. There's a lot of guys that might lose some confidence coming off an injury like this. He's going to be back, and he's going to have the option to play both football and baseball, drafted by the Atlanta Braves.
Don't forget, yeah, terrific baseball player. And he'll have that decision to make.
Number 27.
Brown is tripped up. Well, the first half compared to half number 2 for Oregon, 205 yards rushing, 123 in the second half. 279, 230. Look at the points. 18 in the first, and they put 31 up. But don't forget, the defense chipped in 2 touchdowns.
21 points off a turnover. There were 3 turnovers they converted into 21 points. That was a big part of it. But this Oregon offense has been in control the whole game as well. They really had a good game plan, fantastic execution. And you got to just say today was definitely their day.
Tyree. with the punt, angles to the corner. It's taken down by Edwards at the 5, at the 10, and then steps out of bounds around the 13-yard line. Now it's time for the five-star play of the game presented by Wrangler.
Well, no mystery, the 71-yard touchdown run by Jonathan Stewart early in the game, second quarter. That was really the game, the play that broke the game open, put Oregon firmly in control. Jonathan Stewart happy to take advantage of the big hole provided by his offensive line.
A 253-yard rushing game for Jonathan Stewart. Four minutes to play. South Florida with the football. And let's check out our Ruby Tuesday player of the game. Who else but Jonathan Stewart? I mentioned the 253 on the ground. Also a touchdown by air. The career high today of 253.
It speaks for itself. 253 yards running the ball against a very good run defense in South Florida. Could have made a case for Justin Roper, the job he did today. But the key, we said it in the open. Interception.
Watch out. Clear sailing. Touchdown, Oregon.
Well, it just gets worse for South Florida, better for Oregon.
55-21.
And that's about as easy an interception as you're ever going to see.
You know, and what's great in a game like this, I mean, even though it's lopsided, Steve Berline, both these teams have been able to use a lot of players. Final game of the season. They're going 5 and 6 deep with Oregon's defense, and South Florida's also used a lot of players that rarely see action.
You're getting chances to get guys out there on the field that normally wouldn't get a chance to be out there on the football field. Right here, Grant Gregory going down, tries to throw a pass, and that's DiVincenzo, a guy who I think it's safe to say hasn't been a big part of their defense during the course of the season, but right there showing he can play too. And boy, what a thrill for him to catch that pass and take it in for a touchdown.
A moment in time he will never forget.
No doubt about it.
Well, another Sun Bowl fact, 56 points scored today by Oregon. That's a new Sun Bowl record. You know, much like New England in the National Football League, record after record, Oregon has a few, a couple they like and a couple they won't like, and that's the main one is the penalties that we saw today. Combining penalties between South Florida and Oregon.
Well, I think Mike Bellotti, he'll even get over the fact that they had all those penalties in the first half. The way his team came out and played the second half, extremely impressive.
So the Ducks are set to kick again. Turnovers, defense will be the story in the second half.
Well, we gave the player of the game, we give to Jonathan Stewart. And that reason being that running game really did set the tone. It made Justin Roper's job much more manageable out there. He took advantage of the opportunity. Fantastic performance for all these guys.
Kick is short at the 5-yard line. Johnson racing, turns on the jets and crashes down at the 32-yard line. Don't forget tomorrow, the Konica Minolta Gator Bowl. You'll see it here on CBS. Texas Tech taking on 20th-ranked Virginia. That's tomorrow, 1 Eastern, here on CBS. Bert Lundquist, Gary Danielson on the call. As we look down on the Sun Bowl. And could not have enjoyed a better day. I mean, blue skies, 54 degrees as we kicked it. It got into the low 60s this afternoon. Beautiful day.
Well, I got in Friday morning. It was downright chilly for a couple days here Friday, Saturday, but they kept saying it was going to be up at 60 and sunny today. It was absolutely picture perfect all day long.
Gregory will tuck and run out of a tackle or two. And Steve, let's go back and update above the line.
Well, we said for the Oregon offense, it comes down to third down, 8 of 14. That's pretty solid right there for Oregon. USF defense forced the issue. They have caused very little problem for this Oregon offense at all. They've not done a very good job of creating problems for the USF, for the South Florida offense. Went in the red zone, they did not. They had two chances to be in the red zone. They were 0-for-2, ended up with field goals. And then the final point being
Grothy's
the takeaways
wheels.
From Grothy's wheel. Takeaway, Grothy's wheels. He was really never a factor other than a few plays in that first half. Came out and made a couple plays with his feet, throwing the ball, running the ball. Overall wins all the way across the board for Oregon.
I got a feeling they're sneaking on the sideline. I got a feeling that the bucket's coming for Mike Bellotti.
Yeah, is he gonna sniff it out?
Heads up. Got him. Got him. Clock running. Celebration on the Oregon sideline. And Steve, the Ducks will go to 9-4 on the season. And that ends that three-game losing streak to end the regular season campaign, while South Florida will go to 9-4. Still, those nine wins, don't forget, ties their school record.
A great season, tremendous season for South Florida. And for Oregon to end it on a positive note after the last three games, great way to end the season for them. You know, these are both teams that are going to be right in the middle of it next year, because they're going to do nothing but get better as they go into next year.
That pass was intended for A.J. Love. That stops the clock with 1:34 to play. Again, we want to thank the Sun Bowl committee for hosting CBS and all of our crew. Do a great job here in El Paso. The whole town, the whole city comes together.
The city is just so proud of the city. All the people here absolutely love being in El Paso, and they love showing it off, and they really do roll out the red carpet for us every year. We are much appreciative of that.
That punt will bounce into the end zone. And 1:26 to play.
First and 10 for the Ducks at their 20-yard line.
I think the question we got to ask, too, though, now you talk about Oregon. Dennis Dixon, now he's going to be moving on to the next level. You've got the opportunity to see Justin Roper. Who's going to be the factor to step in for Oregon when it all gets down to it next year? We'll see how they can respond to life without Dennis Dixon. I think today was a pretty good start for him.
Yeah, that quarterback battle will be interesting come spring football, especially the way that Roper performed in this ball game.
Well, lost in the shuffle of all this was the fact that Nathan Costa, who was a sophomore quarterback who would have really gotten a chance to play when Dennis Dixon went down after Brady Leaf got hurt, he's the kid that blew his knee out in practice and never got a chance to see the field, and that was what given really Justin Roper his opportunity to play today. So the two of them, I'm sure, will have a nice competition going into next year.
Second and eight.
That brings up second down and eight as we hit 1 minute to play. Now fans in Oregon and Eugene especially will be excited tonight as the new year approaches. Ducks letting that play clock run out. And the snap taken with five on the play clock on the keeper. And Cody Kemp to the 40-yard line.
Kemp trying to take advantage of his opportunity to play to another redshirt freshman.
All about Jonathan Stewart today, 253 yards, and he still looks refreshed, does he not?
He does. He does. I cannot get over how easy it was for this running game of Oregon. The offensive line needs to be recognized, too. They did a fantastic job of opening up those seams to get Jonathan Stewart up in there. He'd be the first one to pass the credit on to them, I'm sure.
So Kemp set to take what should be the final snap of the Sun Bowl. On the keeper, stumbling to the 45. And they're going to keep the clock running. That's it. Oregon wins the 74th Sun Bowl. 56-21. For Steve Erline, Sam Ryan, Craig Bowlerjack, we say so long from the Sun Bowl in El Paso. Oregon 56, South Florida 14. This has been a presentation of CBS Sports.